Folks, you don't mess with Texas. Down here, everything's bigger and faster. When they come spinning out at turn four right here off to my left, they're going to be approaching speeds of up to 200 miles as the chase for the next L Cup narrows. Welcome, everybody. I'm Brett Musburger. All of the experts agree. It has come down to a two-man chase between Jeff Gordon and Jimmy Johnson. Teammates are only 9 points ahead. Folks, do not go to sleep on Clint Bowyer. If anything happens to those lead two, he's only 111 back. We got a lot of drama headed your way. And to tell you what's in store coming up, let's go to the pit studio, and here's my colleague, Susie Culver. Susie?
Brett, closest chase ever with three to go, and we like that here in the pit studio with Rusty Wallace and Brad Daugherty. Because they are teammates at the top, more intriguing or less intriguing?
Oh, more intriguing, that's for sure.
Absolutely more intriguing. Remember, pressure creates diamonds.
Jeff Gordon, Jimmy Johnson have won the last four races, but oddly, they've never won here at Texas. So here's where we stand. Gordon with just a 9-point edge over Johnson. How close is that? 9 points represents at most just three positions on the track. Now, technically, all 12 drivers are still alive, although many could be eliminated today. But if all goes Clint Bowyer's way, he could actually leave Texas with a 50-point lead. And Tony Stewart, who has won at all three remaining tracks, is always a threat. In a perfect smoke world, if he did win all three, he could gain 483 points. Of course, that would mean that Jeff Gordon and Jimmy Johnson would have to falter. Tim Brewer made this point, that it's a great game of cat and mouse between those two guys. If one guy runs hard, the other has to be there. If one guy lays back, there's a big decision to make. Are these two guys just racing each other?
No, they're not racing each other whatsoever. Look, they're very aware where each other's at, but they got to go out there and race the rest of the field. There's 41 other guys out there trying to beat their brains in. So they're going to hammer down, run hard, but they'll be aware, Brad, where the rest of those guys are at.
See, I think it's come down to a two-man race. I think there's so much pressure. We in the media talk about it all the time. They have the two best race cars, the two best race teams, two great race car drivers. I think the pressure is mounting insurmountably on these two guys, and I think they're aware of one another almost to a point where it could be detrimental if they over-strategize and don't run hard.
Well, Brad, it's looked like a two-man race right now, but if those guys make a mistake, that can lose them the championship. Let's face it, Susie. They've been running all year long side by side, and it's going to come down to mistake being happening. That's going to cost these guys a championship if it does happen.
All right, so who would you say is under more pressure, Jeff or Jimmy?
Oh, absolutely, Jeff Gordon. I mean, yesterday, we're watching him in practice, and I heard something out of his voice that really made a lot of people nervous. He was very concerned, really didn't know what was going on with the car. And Jimmy Johnson, on the other hand, he's real confident. He won Martinsville. He's won Atlanta. He's got a great crew chief, and he's on a roll. That's big.
Yeah, I think Jeff Gordon has the most pressure on him. Jeff's like the old gunslinger. I heard him say earlier this week that 9-point lead, oh, it's nothing. We're actually running head-to-head. It's even. He's trying to diffuse the pressure. The old guy, though, the old experienced Jeff Gordon, the old grizzly vet, I think he gets it done in the end, though.
You know what's been so key, though, is neither of these guys, if they do make a mistake, they're great at recovering. How does a team do that?
They've got such good teams. There's so much depth in the Hendrick Motorsports team. It's just unbelievable. Great engineering staff, good horsepower, and a lot of information. When they get behind, they can go to their teammate, or they can go to the engineers and sit down and say, look, I've got a problem. Help me. And you know what? That might be the other guy's engineer they're talking to.
Yeah.
They share a lot of stuff.
And that's what we've seen all year long. When they did have mistakes or anything go wrong, they always bounce back and come back even stronger. So my theory is, as they go into these last few races, the guy who flinches first, who makes the biggest mistake, will lose the championship. I don't necessarily think they're going to outrun one another. I think whoever is mistake-free walks away with the trophy.
And a mistake could be a blown right rear tire, right. A blown right front tire, running over debris, something they have no control over.
That's exactly right.
Oh, but then you have Clint Bowyer's like just sitting there in wait. He's had career bests at 6 of the 7 stops, and right now he's with Jamie Little.
That's right, Susie. You definitely cannot count him out. That's kind of our motto right now. He's 111 points away from Jeff Gordon for the lead. And on Friday, Jeff Gordon said, you have been extremely impressive in this chase run. He said he never really saw you out there, and then boom, the chase starts, and there you've been. What has it been like for you running with Jeff Gordon and Jimmy Johnson? You guys have been so competitive. What has it been like for you as a driver?
It's just been so much fun to be a part of it. I mean, everybody's had to pick up the program so much. It's just so much fun to see everybody, you know, push themselves to the limits. Not only myself, Gil on the box, everybody throughout the organization. Just really proud of everybody behind me in this Jack Daniels Chevrolet, and just excited about it.
Well, today, Clint Bowyer rolls off 29th, and you definitely have to keep your eye on him today and see what happens, because he's been pulling it out and beating Jeff Gordon. Susie?
Well, here at Texas Motor Speedway, driver introductions are just getting underway, and Dave Burns has caught up with Jimmy Johnson.
Anytime. Hey, guys, I have caught up with Jimmy. Anytime, and now is the time. Jimmy, you have got a chance to win this championship. It's within reach. You're racing one of your... Thanks for holding on to me. You're racing one of your best friends in the world, and you've never won here at Texas. What kind of pressures are you feeling?
No more pressure than I would typically put on myself. The good thing I have is we got a great race car. And yesterday in practice, really found some things that made the car comfortable to drive. And with this, the points being like they are, you've got to race for this thing. It's not about protecting anything. And I work better in that position having to go race for it. So I'm just excited and looking forward to it.
All right, Brad, you already said he shouldn't hold back. Doesn't sound like he's going to.
Well, nobody's holding back. So it's sort of been the storyline that we've been having fun with since the beginning of the season, whether Clint is in it or not. Have you changed your tune?
Clint may be getting back into this thing. Even though he's 111 points back, these two guys racing each other just feverishly could create a scenario that puts Clint Bowyer back in the saddle
again. He's been everybody's dark horse, yeah. And there's a lot of people pulling for him. They always pull for the underdog.
Absolutely.
And he's kind of the underdog right now.
That's exactly right.
The largest deficit ever overcome with three races to go was 49 points by Dale Earnhardt in 1990. And we know you've got a race to call.
Well, I'm going to run across the track, run up the grandstands, get up with Dr. Jerry Punch and Andy Patriot. Guys, we'll be talking later. We'll have a good race.
Absolutely.
Today. We're looking forward to it, and we're keeping an eye on the countdown clock because green is quickly approaching, Brent.
It is indeed, Susie, and Dale Jr. is still looking for his first win of 2007. Earlier this week, he tested for his new team and owner, Mr. Rick Hendrick. Not the first time we've seen Jr. in the number five at this track. And actor Vince Vaughn is also in a new car. We'll have more on his introduction to a pace car. He'll be driving Jimmy Johnson and the rest of the field to the green flag today. And Dallas Mavericks star and race grand marshal Dirk Nowitzki will be giving the command to rev him up. We're closing in on green as you're watching ESPN on ABC.
NASCAR Countdown on ABC, brought to you by Chevy, an American Revolution.
Aerial coverage of Texas Motor Speedway brought to you by Goodyear, the official tire of NASCAR, helping NASCAR drivers get to the finish line for the past 50 years. Monday, Ray Lewis anchors the Ravens' wildly deceptive defense against Ben Roethlisberger and the division-leading Steelers. Monday Night Football on ESPN at 8:30 p.m. Eastern Time. Here in Texas, Jeff Gordon, the points leader, and starting on the outside of the front row, and he is with Mike Massaro.
And over the years, Susie, Jeff Gordon has certainly had a love-hate relationship with this speedway, but based upon what you've experienced so far this weekend, which side of the fence are you on, the love it or hate it side?
Well, Friday, we're loving it. The car was awesome right off the truck. And, yesterday we were battling with it. We certainly weren't loving it, but you know what? Having good track position and an awesome race team like I have with this DuPont Chevrolet team, I feel pretty good about it. This track's been good to us here lately, so lately, been more on the love side than the hate side.
And we can see why. He led 173 laps here in the spring. Now let's go to Alan Bestock, who's with our Bud Pole winner, Martin Truex Jr.
And on the ride around the track with Martin Truex, Martin, clean air seemed to be key words and a key strategy for today's race. Why?
Well, you go so fast here in these cars, you rely so much on downforce to get your speed. It just helps a lot to get out front. Your car will run faster. It feels a whole lot better to drive with all that air on it. So hopefully we've got clean air to start with. Hopefully we can keep it all day long.
Thank you, Martin. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Martin Truex Jr. going to lead the field to the green flag. He's hoping, Susie, to lead him to the checkers.
And Truex's DEI teammate, part of the big news coming out of Atlanta this week, important COT testing for the mile-and-a-half tracks, but overshadowing the test, the symbolic beginning for Dale Earnhardt Jr. with Hendrick Motorsports. Jr., driving a white number 5, said he liked the way the car handled. It wasn't his first run in the number 5. Remember, right here in Texas last April, Kyle Busch had crashed out, and because of some miscommunication, Busch left the track thinking his day was done. Meantime, with 3 laps to go, Dale Jr. climbed in and finished the race. As for today, how will crew chiefs keep their guys on track and beat the unseasonable heat? Here's Tim Brewer at the Chevy Cutaway car in the Dish Tech Center.
We come to Texas, it's all about temperature right now because it's unseasonably warmer than the crew chief seen it here in quite some time. What we're going to have to do to adjust for the temperature of the car, we're going to have to take a little bit more tape off the nose of the car. What that's going to do, we're going to have to give up a little bit of downforce in the front. Therefore, we're going to have to go back and adjust on our car to make it better throughout the day with the heat on the racetrack it's harder to make a car run more consistent. So what we're going to have to do is go back and work on our chassis a little bit harder than what we normally have to get it to run throughout the day here in Texas.
Cutaway Car is brought to you by Chevy, the most wins in NASCAR history in American Revolution.
The destination they all hope to reach today. It's quiet now, but Victory Lane at Texas Motor Speedway is a wild experience. The trophy, hand-carved boots, or a sterling silver cowboy hat. The winner's name immediately engraved on the backdrop. You've even got pistols, all awash in red, white, and blue confetti. Counting down to 500 miles at the Great American Speedway, a little over 20 minutes. And they love their stock car racing in the Lone Star State. This telecast is available on ABC HD, presented by DLP HD TV. NASCAR coverage continues next week with the NASCAR Busch Series at Phoenix on ESPN2, Saturday at 4 Eastern. And the chase for the Nextel Cup down to just two races next Sunday on ABC. Coverage begins with NASCAR Countdown at 3 Eastern. Now here at Texas Motor Speedway, Vince Vaughn getting into the act.
What's up, Repo 9? Teaching you.
How are you, boss?
How are you,
nice man? To see you.
Breaker, breaker, come on back with it. Come on back with it.
So what should we do first?
I think we ought to start.
Let's do it. Come on. So I bet that bank feels like you're going to turn, huh?
Oh, when you get out there, you'll feel it.
Yeah.
And then go out on the track and take a left.
Okay, great.
No faster than 45.
We're at 46. Is that okay?
Slow it down. Okay, tell the tower you're 45.
So I say?
Caution car to tower.
Caution car to tower?
4-5 tower.
4-5 tower. Do I stay at 45 going into pit row?
Yep, stay at 45. And slow down. Slow down when you get up there. There you go.
Perfect. I appreciate it. Thank you, pal.
Vince Vaughn isn't just in the pace car, he's driving the pace car, and that's a really big deal. I hope he'll be here on the set during the race, and we'll chat with him about it. We also want to recognize Carl Edwards, who wrapped up the Busch Series title yesterday. Put that in perspective.
Well, Carl had a great season, got a big start early in the series, and then had some troubles as the end of the year came along, but he'll be a great representative for the Busch Series. Congratulations to Carl Edwards.
And it's time to go here with the cup. Chase is coming down to it, Brent.
It is indeed, Susie. Three races left. We're heading for home. Biggest reaction by the fans here, Jeff Gordon and Dale Earnhardt Jr. Now let's go to the track for the invocation.
Army Continental Color Guard present our nation's colors. Please remain standing as Dr. Roger Marsh from Texas Alliance Raceway Ministries offers today's invocation. Heavenly Father, as we gather this afternoon at the Great American Speedway, we give thanks for this outrageously beautiful day. And we recognize that it is a display of your goodness and your power. We also are very grateful for the excitement of NASCAR racing and for all the work, sponsorship, and popularity that contribute to its success. And finally, Lord, we thank you for the freedom to enjoy racing, and we ask you to protect those who defend those and other freedoms. And we ask you to continue to guide and direct the United States of America, and God bless Texas in Jesus' name. Amen. Please welcome the Texas Christian University Band as they perform our national anthem.
NASCAR troops around the globe. So we settle in now. Jeff Gordon and Jimmy Johnson, friends and only 9 points apart in the race for the Nextel Cup. They're coming up now, 500 miles of unfriendly pavement between those two. We go topside. Dr. Jerry Punch, Rusty Wallace, and Andy Petrie. Take it away, Doc.
Thank you, Brent. Just three races remain in the chase for the Nextel Cup, and on the strength of back-to-back wins, Jimmy Johnson has pulled over the 9 points of series leader Jeff Gordon. Clint Bowyer holds steady in third. Carl Edwards, who won the NASCAR Busch Series title here yesterday, moved up to fourth spot. Ironically, neither Jeff Gordon nor Jimmy Johnson have ever won a Cup race here at Texas, and in fact, this place has been a thorn in their sides. Back in April of this year, Jimmy Johnson was caught up in an early crash and finished a distant 38th. And folks, Jeff Gordon has suffered two of the hardest hits of his career here. Back in 1999, this one forced him to finish 43rd. And folks, that is dead last in the field. Hello, everyone, along with the champs, Rusty Wallace and Andy Petrie. I'm Jerry Punch. Glad to have you with us here for what is a championship showdown NASCAR style in the Lone Star State. Okay, Rusty, now you're Jeff Gordon. You've never won here. This place has really bitten you hard twice. How does that affect you mentally here today?
Well, Jerry, it affects me really big time, and here's one reason. Last night in practice, he was obviously shooken up. His car's not handling right. You know, we watched Jeff Gordon all year long with maybe a car's not fast in practice, but he always pulls it out. I heard a different voice in Jeff Gordon, so there could be concern in that camp, because when practice was over, he was 31st.
Andy, last week in Atlanta, we saw the outcome dictated by the calls late on pit road. Now, take us inside the minds of these two top crew chiefs, Steve Letarte for Gordon, Chad Knaus for Johnson. Who has the edge when it comes to a critical late call today?
Well, both of these guys trained under Ray Evernham, who led Jeff Gordon to two or three titles, actually. And so they know what they're doing. They're both great crew chiefs, but they have different styles. Steve Letarte's a little more laid back, and he's quietly confident, while Chad Knaus is a more intense kind of guy, and he's kind of quick on his feet. I have to give the edge to Chad Knaus because he's been here, he's won the championship, and there's no substitute for that kind of experience.
Both want to walk away with a great feeling about Texas, finally, for the first time in their career. And speaking of great Texas memories, today's in-race reporter, Dale Earnhardt Jr., will never forget that very first Cup win and coveted hug from his famous father back in April of 2000. We'll talk to him in just a moment after these messages and a word from our ABC stations.
Ladies and gentlemen, here to give the most famous words in motorsports, please welcome today's Grand Marshal, Dallas Mavericks and NBA MVP, Dirk Nowitzki.
Children, start your engine!
Come on, gang, crank them up.
Crank it up.
All right, fired up. Fired up.
All right, boys, let's double-check our equipment. We got a good car here. Ready to go do this. Let's not beat ourselves today. It's going to be a long race. Pay attention. Heads up on pit road. Let's not beat ourselves.
Have a good day, buddy. Long way to go here. You know how to win this race. Guys, be solid in the pit.
2-4, thank you.
What a slam dunk of a command by Dirk Nowitzki here. The engines have fired. 43 of NASCAR's finest know what happens next. So let's show you who they are and where they start. 27-year-old Martin Truex becomes the fourth first-time pole winner and the 17th overall different driver to win a pole in 2007. He'll be flanked by points leader Jeff Gordon in row one. Now, while you watch to see where your favorite driver will start, let's visit with our in-race reporter, the driver of the Budweiser Chevrolet, Dale Earnhardt Jr., who starts back in 12th today.
Hey, Dale Jr., Rusty Wallace up on ESPN. You got us?
Yes, sir, Rusty.
Hey, Dale, this is the place where you won your first NASCAR Nextel Cup race, man. And I tell you what, that was a big moment with your father being on victory lane there with you. But yesterday in practice, your car looked great. Is this car strong enough to win today?
Yeah, we always run really good here. It's always been a good track for me. And we did have a good car yesterday in practice. We're going to start the race just like we were. We were the most happiest with it, so... Hopefully, we'll have some good luck today. We love these fans here. They always get pretty excited when we come to Texas, so it's always a lot of fun.
Hey, Dale, a lot of guys have been crashing off of turn two. You know, that track flattens out pretty quick over there, and you've been pretty known for running that high line right up against that wall. You concerned about that at all with all that going on off of turn two?
Texas, this track, for some reason, both ends, very tricky. You lose the nose, then you lose the back right up next to the wall. Just have to be ready for that. Guys getting up under your back bumper there on exit can spin you out. We've seen it all before several times. So you just have to be real careful, man. It's just tough. The top groove seemed to work good yesterday in the Busch race. So if we need to, we can get up there and try, but I want to run the bottom as much as I can. That's where we're trying to get our car to work.
All right, man, you've had every race you've been in, it seems like it's always top five, you're leading, and something happens. But you know what? I don't think it's going to happen today. I think you're going to bring this baby home. Have a good race, man.
Thanks a lot.
Calling the shots for Dale will be crew chief Tony Gibson. Let's visit with him.
Hey, Tony Gibson, Andy Petrie up here. You got a copy?
Yeah, go ahead, Andy.
Hey, Tony, how hard are you guys working to try to get Dale Jr. and Victor Lane before this season's out?
Pretty hard. Luck hasn't been on our side here lately, but, you know, everybody here has gave 110%, the whole company has, and we really, really want to win with Dale Jr. before the year's up. You know, obviously he has continued to drive his heart out and gave us everything he can, so it's up to us to give him a great car so we can get this done.
Hey, we heard Dale Jr. talking about running on the bottom, but he practiced that car up on the top lane yesterday, and it looked like the car was really good up there. Does it take a different setup for the top side of the racetrack versus the bottom?
Well, I think you got to kind of compromise. You know, you want to run around the bottom, but when the grip goes away down there, you know, you can make some ground up on top. So he's obviously the best up there at the top. So, you know, but you still got to be a run around the bottom. You got to be able to dig on the bottom. You know, for the first 10 or 12 laps, and then once that grip goes away, you got to be able to go up to the top. So it takes a little bit of a compromise on the setup wise to, you know, like I said, you got to run the bottom too. So I think we'll be fine today. The track's going to change a couple times. Hopefully we can stay up on top of it.
10-4, Tony. Hey, the race is on ABC now. Switch that monitor off that football and get it back on the race, bud.
Yeah, I hear you, old man. All right, appreciate it.
Hey, have a good one, Tony.
Yeah, it's been 59 races since Dale Earnhardt Jr. has gone to victory lane back in May of 2006. Could that streak end here today? There are so many great stories we'll be following throughout the afternoon. Let's fill you in on some of them as we head down to the pits and our Mike Massaro.
Well, Doc, one thing that could separate the competition today is how well drivers are able to keep the good in their good years. As this track has aged, it's become much more abrasive, and tire management has been a much greater factor. Now, throughout the course of the afternoon, these drivers will be searching for grip, and as they do that, they'll change their lines. They'll be working from the bottom of the racetrack to the top of the racetrack and back to the bottom again, all the while scraping their tire against the grain of the asphalt. That will create some abuse. The driver who abuses his tire the least and finds the optimum line around this racetrack could be the driver that goes to victory lane. Let's go to Dave Burns.
Mike, good people are what Richard Childress relies on every weekend on all of his teams, and all the good people of Richard Childress Racing have gotten Clint Bowyer in a position to win this championship, and they'll count on all of them again today. Further down pit road, Kevin Harvick's team. Further up pit road, Jeff Burton's team, and engineers and crew chiefs communicating with each other back and forth, electronically a lot of times through instant messaging, but Burton is only three pit stalls down that way. If they needed to, they could practically shout instructions to each other to try to help Clint Bowyer's team, the closest to winning the championship, make it to the end. That's what it's all about, and the 07 team's going to keep fighting with more than a little help from their friends. Jamie?
Well, Dave, it was 1 year ago that Jimmy Johnson and the 48 team took over the points and secured their first ever NASCAR Nextel Cup Championship. I talked to Chad Knaus earlier today, and, you know, a lot of people said, could that team get any better? He said, heck yeah, we can. This has been our best year yet. Why? He said it's been a cumulative effort. It's not just a great driver. It's not just great pit stalls, pit calls from the pit stand. It's this crew and what they do. One guy in particular, Ron Malik, the rear tire carrier, the car chief, he's the man that stepped up and took over as interim crew chief when Chad Knaus was suspended for 6 weeks earlier in the season. He kept this team focused, and Chad said it's that kind of determination, that kind of focus and trust that sets the 48 team apart and will take them to their second consecutive championship in 2 weeks. Alan Bestwick?
But Jamie, Jeff Gordon says that one of these two drivers, Jeff and Jimmy Johnson, is going to have a problem in these final three races, and that's going to be the margin of victory in the championship. Some sort of mistake, some sort of bad luck in these final few weeks. Jeff Gordon thinks a flat tire, maybe one small slip on the racetrack, a pit error, could turn out to be the difference over these final few weeks. In this 500-mile race on a fast and tricky track against 42 tough competitors, there'll be more than a little tension trying to avoid that one mistake today.
Alan, who will flinch first? Like a good old-time Texas gunfight, if you blink or bobble, you will lose. They can ill afford a mistake here down the stretch in the chase for the NASCAR Nextel Cup. 8 high-definition onboard cameras will give you looks all over the field here today throughout the 500 miles. Dale Earnhardt Jr., we've already told you, driving the Budweiser Chevrolet, Rain Race Reporter. Denny Hamlin starts 7th in the FedEx Freight Chevrolet. Tony Stewart starts 15th in the Home Depot Chevy. He won this race a year ago, by the way. Kevin Harvick starts 4th in the Shell Penske Chevy. Jeff Burton, who won here back in the spring, starts 27th in the AT&T Chevrolet. Second man in points, Jimmy Johnson, starts 8th in the Lowe's Chevrolet. Tony Raines starts 40th at Texas Instruments DLP Chevy. Carl Edwards, a newly crowned NASCAR Busch Series champion, starts 21st in the Office Depot Chevy. Today's race is 500 miles on a 1.5 mile oval. Folks, 334 laps. There's the pit window, 50 to 55 laps. Turns are banked at 24 degrees, straightaways at just 5 degrees. They came from Atlanta Motor Speedway a week ago for an exciting finish on a 1.5 mile track, but this is 1.5 miles, guys, but a different character racetrack.
Definitely, Jerry, you're exactly right. The cars are exiting turn two right now. There's a lot of banking exiting that corner, but the banking falls off very fast. And in practice, a lot of guys scrub the wall right over there. Now look, off of turn four, the same thing happens, but not nearly as bad. So like Dale Jr. said, he'll be aware of it. It's a little tricky, Andy, in those corners, and the driver's got to be ready for it.
And downforce is a real big issue when you go to a flat racetrack, a little more than it is at a banked racetrack. This is almost a cross between the two because these corners are so flat entering and exiting that the track actually races more like a flat track.
Here's your recipe, folks, for a great afternoon. You take 11 former Texas Motor Speedway winners. You add 8 former NASCAR Nextel Cup champions. You add 1 newly crowned NASCAR Busch champion. You stir in over 190,000 diehard NASCAR fans. And add a national television audience, folks. That should all be 500 miles of fun. Glad to have you with us. Sit back and enjoy as the pace truck pulls away. Martin Truex and Jeff Gordon will lead him down. NASCAR fans on their feet as the chase gets underway at Texas Motor Speedway. Down the backstretch, first time pole sitter Martin Truex wants to lead the first lap. Jeff Gordon has already dropped a spot back to third.
And you see some of the cars moving to the top of the racetrack already. The track is a little bit dirty up there. Nobody's run on it yet. These are the first few laps. The drivers need to be careful right now. Get that top dusted off.
See, Jeff Gordon's struggling still here on the top side of turn two. He's struggling in practice yesterday, and it looks like the car's not quite where he wants it, at least in these early laps.
He was 31st quickest in practice yesterday. He's concerned about this car a little bit. He's talked to his teammates. They put an alternate setup in it. They feel like they're ready, but it's yet to be seen.
Rusty said you could hear the concern in Gordon's voice during that final happy hour session. He said the car was loose, and suddenly tight in the corner. Very concerned. 24, dropping back. Let's check in his pits with Alan Bestwin.
When I talked with his crew chief, Steve Letard, in the garage this morning, Doc, he wasn't that concerned. He said he and Jeff had to make an appearance together last night. They spent 15 minutes in the back of a car getting there, and in that time decided on the changes they'd make to that car to go from the end of practice yesterday to the start of the race today. They were only a few. They felt like the conditions would come to them as the race went on. We'll see if that turns out to be the case.
I would see A.J. Allmendinger on top of the racetrack now with an obvious problem in his car. And what a tough deal for him. He qualified great for this
Stay
race.
Stay up there. So. Stay up there. You got a long line of coming.
He may have brushed the wall coming off
Stay
the corner
got
here.
Got to be ready.
Whoa. His teammate Vickers almost gets it out of shape and gets right into the other car. He gathers it back up. Allmendinger obviously slowing down.
You got about 10 more coming.
He's already struggling here. Looks like he may have a problem. Denny Hamlin gets in the back of him. Man, he hit the wall pretty good right there.
Oh, and Denny got in the back of him, turned him sideways, and he couldn't hold on to it and got in it. But you're right, Andy. It looked like there was already a problem with his car early in this event.
Yeah, they were battling for fourth position because Allmendinger had qualified fifth. Here are the two championship contenders. Jeff Gordon left of his screen, Jimmy Johnson right. They are currently being shown in fifth and sixth spot.
And guys, can you believe it? These two can't shake each other at all. Everywhere we go, they're bumper to bumper. A lot of people are saying, are they going to race each other today? I don't think so. I believe they're going to be aware where each other's at. But, man, they got to race this track, Andy, and arrest these competitors.
It looked like Jeff Gordon was struggling pretty good in the beginning, but it stabilized a little bit right here. It looks like his car's kind of come in. Track's getting a little slicker. These tires get a little few laps on them, and looks like he may be okay. We heard Steve Letarte say that they hoped the track would come to them, and maybe that's what's going to happen here.
Here's the 42 car, Juan Pablo Montoya, who won an Infinity on early in the year, leading in the Rookie of the Year standings. And he will be leading the race as he comes out of the turn here, turn two, and just sails by Martin Truex in the one car.
Man, he's got this baby hooked up now. I was down there in the garage this morning talking to some guys, some crew chiefs, and the consensus was this one car was going to drive off in the sunset on this first run. But, boy, Montoya's not letting this happen at all. He's got his car hooked up.
Oh, not at all. This Chip Ganassi, Felix Sabatis racing team, I mean, they're getting stronger and stronger. And yesterday, the other teammate, Reed Sorensen, was third quick in practice. I talked to Montoya. He said, this is the car, Rusty, that I had in Indianapolis that ran so well for me. So I really like this car.
Martin Truex hugging the bottom of the racetrack, but no, now back in second spot. Jamie?
Well, Doc, this is a 79th start for Martin Truex Jr., and when he started this race on the pole for the first time, his crew chief, Kevin Mannion, said, this is the first time we're ever starting in the front. He said, be ready. We're going to make some crazy calls and set the world on its end. Hey, they have nothing to lose. They're 12th in the points, so we're going to watch Martin Truex Jr. Alan?
And I talked to the new leader, Juan Pablo Montoya, just before the start of this race. Juan Pablo did not know, really, how his car was at the end of practice yesterday. He said, we didn't put the fast lap on the board like other guys. I felt like it was okay, but I'm not really sure. I guess we're going to find out. Well, I guess we just found out.
Good race car left of your screen, Montoya. And here's the points battle. Here are the teammates. As the 48 of Jimmy Johnson trying to go by Jeff Gordon on the racetrack and in the point standings.
Jerry, it doesn't look like his car's in too bad a shape. He's got a lot of racing here left in front of him, a lot of time than just. And Andy, this car is a lot better than we anticipated it was going to be in practice. In practice, he was in big time trouble. The car doesn't look too bad right now.
But you got to know that this team is so good and so much depth in it that they're not going to, even though they have a bad practice, doesn't mean they're going to race bad. And they're showing that right now.
You got to wonder, Jimmy Johnson was the fastest car in happy hour. We've already mentioned that Jeff Gordon was 31st. You think they've worked together as far as trying to help the 24 out, even though they're running against each other in points?
Absolutely, Doc. These guys get together probably after every single session and compare notes. Even though their driving styles are different, I know that these guys are talking to each other and they're going to get this thing right. And Chad Knaus cares if this 24 runs good. He wants it to run good. They want to race this thing out on the racetrack.
What about a former Indianapolis 500 winner and Formula One winner, Juan Pablo Montoya? He is the early leader, the 32-year-old from Columbia, showing the way here at Texas Motor Speedway. Welcome back to the Great American Speedway here in Fort Worth, Texas, and we are under caution quickly here this afternoon. Lap 14, there's the culprit, the 15 car of Paul Menard on pit road getting some repair work done. Let's show you what happened to Paul up in turn four.
Looks like Paul just got high in the racetrack, went at turn three, trying to be really run that high line, and Andy, the car just got out from underneath him. Looks like he got a little too high.
He may have got just outside of that groove there. Even though these cars are running extremely high, he was about a half a width higher than most of them had been.
Watch Clint Bowyer just get by now. He's third in the points, so a pretty good evasive move by the 07.
Yeah, you can see he was going right at the wall, and he got so close to the wall, his initial entry, he shot right up to it, the rim ride, the top of it, much like Dale Jr. and some of the guys have been doing. But he just got about a foot too high, got up in that dirty part of the racetrack, and the back end of that car came around on him.
You can see him keep driving the car to keep it off the wall. Did a good job.
First caution flag of the afternoon. Here they come on the pit road for the first time. Championship contenders, 48 Jimmy Johnson, 24 Jeff Gordon. Let's go down to the pits and Alan Bestwick.
Well, Jeff Gordon's team may be about to play the first strategy move of this race, Doc. Steve Letarte waving at his crew like they may take two tires here on this stop. Gordon slides into his pit stall. They'll go around to change these right side tires. The bottom left box on the screen, that's Letarte, top left. Let's see if they take lefts when they come back around. Nope, just going to be rights, Jamie.
And Chad Knaus calling his driver, Jimmy Johnson, in. They want to go down on that panhard bar, one round, make an air pressure adjustment in those left sides. He said he's loose in, four tires. Jimmy Johnson's down and away.
Coming hot up, right?
So the gauntlet has been thrown down in terms of strategy. Here's the race off. Jeff Gordon, only two right side tires. And Ryan Newman up five spots. Kenseth up nine positions. Hamlin back six spots on that exchange of pit stops.
ESPN's coverage of NASCAR Nextel Cup Series on ABC. Brought to you by Allstate, the official insurance sponsor of NASCAR. Coca-Cola, thanks for drinking. And the Ford F-150, built Ford tough.
Back at Texas Motor Speedway, green flag waving here, and Jeff Gordon will get the 5 bonus points for leading a lap. And folks, remember, he took only 2 right side tires, as did the 99 of Edwards and the 17 of Kenza. Guys, is that a good move to only take 2 rights for Gordon early on?
It looks good right now. He got the 5 bonus points. He's out front, but we saw yesterday in the Busch race that this wasn't that good of a decision.
No, not at all. You saw Kyle Busch put 2 tires on his car yesterday and went to the back like a rock. Those 2 tires fell off awful quick.
Caution's out. Turn 2.
Caution flag for the second time today. This is the 84 of Allmendinger, who had already been slowing. And he had been on and off a pit
pretty
road.
Pretty good. Right-sided it.
Yeah, his problems are continuing here because of the damage earlier. Probably cut a right front tire.
Yeah, that car was really tore up because of the first part of the race and tore up a lot, so this probably caused a big problem. Let's take a look at his pit stop.
Now watch the, they have a commitment cone to the top of the pit road there. See the 16 of Biffle trying to get around it. And apparently they've hit the cone. That will be a commitment cone violation by what we're being told is Biffle, Elliott, and Menard.
See, Greg Biffle just takes a left-hand turn, hits the 41 and the 43. Both of these cars get damage on the right front fender and have to spend some time on pit road. They were just victims here.
Man, I tell you, it just goes to show you guys, you got to be so doggone careful out there because this can happen to any one of them. The last minute, Greg Biffle tries to slide in and gets it.
And here's the reason for the caution flag this time. A.J. Allmendinger had that great qualifying effort, his best start of his career, 5th, and he had just brushed the wall on lap 2, and now he's hit it pretty hard and heads back to the garage area. Second caution flag of the afternoon. Back after these messages and a word from our ABC stations. Nextel Cup Series action under caution for the second time today. Contact for A.J. Allmendinger's Toyota. And he is headed down to the garage area. Our leader is Jeff Gordon by virtue of only taking 2 tires. They made the call to take 2. He took 2. Ryan Newman also took 2, as did Carl Edwards and Matt Kenseth. The car right behind him, by the way, Martin Truex, took 4 tires. We'll see if that, how long the 2-tire strategy will work for Jeff Gordon, who got those bonus points and now has led the last 6 consecutive laps. Flag waves. We'll see if Mr. Truex with those 4 fresh tires can do something with the 24 car.
Looks like a good smooth restart on everybody so far. No problems at all. Everybody's lined up and these 2 leaders are getting out of Dodge right now. Now yesterday in the Busch Series race, we watched Kyle Busch take on 2 tires. It worked for about the first 4 or 5 laps, but boy, Andy, that car started falling back big time. Now I know in order to do that, you got to have a pretty good handle on the car. And Jeff might be having that situation right now.
One has to wonder what the thinking was with Steve Letarte, the crew chief for Jeff Gordon, and making the call. And obviously looks like a pretty good call right now. He's holding on. Let's find out because our Alan Beswick has already talked with him. AB.
Yeah, let's not wonder any long, Doc. Well, they only had 14 laps on the left side tires. The right side tires have been the heavier wear all weekend. So it wasn't that big a chance on not changing the lefts from that concern, from the tire wear concern. They got the 5 bonus points you mentioned before, and they got clean air. On these mile-and-a-half track races for the last couple of months, it seems like the guy out front has been able to get away from the pack. The aerodynamic dependence of these cars seemingly has grown greater. That's what he was thinking. See what his driver could do in that clean air. We'll see how it goes in this little run of the race.
Well, Alan, you're exactly right. When it comes to that, that clean air is everything in the world. That is definitely what I call a Mr. Feel-Good when you're driving a car. Your front tires stick real good. You can steer the car real good. And when you get behind those cars, it's like the front of your car is hydroplaning, sliding around, and that's not a good feeling.
Well, here's the one thing. Jeff Gordon's car did not look very good when the race started. So by taking 2 tires and his car not being all that good, I didn't think he would be able to hold the lead this long. But it looks like Martin Truex is just going to take it away from him right here.
Yeah, Martin's getting ready to dirty up that air a little bit in front of the 24 car. He sails by. And speaking of dirtying up the air and maybe a fender or two, let's see what the... Let's watch this 29 and 20 here a moment ago. Harvick in the 29, Tony Stewart in the 20.
Man, boy, Tony Stewart is right up the back of Kevin Harvick. That is one major loose condition. All the air is off the back of your spoiler.
And yeah, Kevin Harvick, he finally just says, hey, man, I give up.
Yeah, Kevin's like, what's the deal, dude? I'm going as hard as I can do. Change lanes, do something, quit running into me, you know? So that's not what you want.
They are battling for 11th and 12th positions. Here's Tony Stewart, who dominated this race last year.
Now, to better remind everybody, these two are friends.
Look at Tony. He's waving out his window, too.
Yeah, Tony Stewart drives Kevin Harvick's Busch Series car.
You say are friends or were friends?
Well, they're maybe friends.
All right, caution flag coming out.
One more time.
Debris He's in done. Turn three. There's the debris. So caution for the third time today here on lap 28.
It's like a little rematch of the Here Kitty Kitty, didn't it?
Yeah, I heard a little bit of radio transmission there. It says one more time, he's done. So I don't know who that was. We'll have to go back and find out. But somebody's mad between the 29 car and the 20. And, guys, we're only 28 laps in this race. We already got tempers flaring.
Well, I don't know how much pushing and shoving I want to do at 193 and a half miles an hour.
Well, not much. When you're running that fast around here, I mean, off of turn four is a tough corner. And turn one, two, three, and four. And Andy, what about the straightaways? They're pretty tough, too.
I think this on racetrack stuff.
Tony Stewart had the frustrations last week, of course, in Atlanta after
He's
starting
back.
He's
not the only one out here. I was trying to pass the damn 26.
That's Kevin Harvick making comments about Tony Stewart, saying he's not the only one out here. I'm trying to pass the 26 car, Jamie McMurray. So they needed this caution right now to cool off a little bit.
And now, boys.
Come on, calm down now.
Kevin Harvick, who don't see any steam coming out of the helmet yet there on the 29. Here's the 15 damage on the front of Paul Menard's car. Remember, Menard spun on lap 14 to bring out that first yellow of the afternoon.
This looks like some new damage. I don't remember seeing his left front fender tore up that bad after that first spin.
Now, I make a prediction. If they pit, Jeff Gordon's going to put four on this time. That's for doggone sure. I mean, he's starting to fall backwards.
I don't think you're going to see these guys come down pit road now, but, you know, this track, man, new tires are worth so much. It's not quite like you see it maybe at Darlington or somewhere like that, but it goes away pretty fast. Here comes some guys.
And a few fakes and a few takers. Here comes the five car of Kyle Busch. He will come on to get service. Casey Mears, his teammate, Casey Kane behind them. Let's check in with Dave.
And Kyle Busch's car was a little bit tight on those runs. He said up top was a little bit better. I could loosen it up a bit, but they're going to make a chassis adjustment as well as a two-tire change for the five. Alan?
And the other Hendrick car, Casey Mears, is in. This car with an extreme tight condition, meaning the front end is sliding in the corners. They're going to change two tires there, see if they can get a little farther up in the pack.
Making some adjustments. Here comes the five car off of pit road. Mears comes down. Others, you see the 96 car. By the way, there was a little contact earlier between the 96 and the 00 for you David Ruderman fans. And Ruderman has been on and off of pit road, making some adjustments to the fender. And speaking of special stops on pit road, how about a special guest in our pit studio? Susie?
Well, we just want to stress how rare it is for anyone outside of NASCAR to drive the pace car. That's Brett Bodine's job. But actor Vince Vaughn had the opportunity today. How did this come about, first of all?
I kept it at 10 and 2. Did you notice?
Absolutely.
I went back to the driver's education class. I kept it as simple as possible.
How'd you get this?
I was just nervous I'd missed the pit turn. I knew if the car started flying by me, I went one lap too many. So I was just glad I got out of the way before the boys started racing. It's incredible to be down here. I was fortunate enough to be down there. You really can appreciate it watching on TV. When you come down and see it live, how close they are and the moves they're making, it's incredible.
But it's a big deal. So how'd you feel?
I was flattered to do it, no question. As I said, it was fun, and I had a guy, Buster, in the car who helped me with everything. Thank you, Buster. What happens in the car stays in the car. Let's keep it quiet. You know what I mean? I didn't panic, Buster. That's not quite the word I would use. No, it was a lot of fun. I enjoyed it. It was a lot of fun to be out there.
How did they wind up asking you? What's your history in terms of auto racing?
No, I've always been a fan, and I was flattered, you know, to get a chance to come down and especially here at Texas Motor Speedway, such a fast course. So I think I have a movie coming out, so everything kind of worked in sync that I was able to come and participate today.
Quick, get the
car. How come you're not in the car? Let's get you out in the car.
I would love that.
I bet you would. That's exciting. You wouldn't even need Buster in the car. Susan, you need this track up. Rubbin's racing. I like the way she handles her business.
Vince, thanks for hanging out with us.
Good to be with you.
Doc?
Oh, did he have a grip on that steering wheel or what, guys? We have Vince Vaughn. Good to have him here visiting with us. Obviously, well, just an outstanding actor, very entertaining both on the big screen and the small screen.
I think temporarily Susie was speechless there just for a second, Doc.
That doesn't happen very often, but that's great.
She wants to get in that car. She'd be a good driver, too, that's for sure.
Okay, let's show you. We're under caution for the third time of day. Debris on the racetrack. Now, watch from Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s onboard camera. See the debris coming out from beneath, off the back of the 31 car.
Whoops, he had a little contact there and probably knocked one of the crush panels loose in the car. And right there it goes.
And that's metal. And if you run over metal with a tire, it blows your tire out. So that was a good call, NASCAR throwing a caution for that problem.
Absolutely. Safety, number one priority here. Chevy pace car takes a hard left, and Martin Truex, our fourth first-time pole sitter in 2007, will lead Kurt Busch, Jeff Gordon, Matt Kenseth, and Juan Pablo Montoya down to the green flag. Montoya getting a little racy back there, looking at a high set. Here goes Kurt Busch on the bottom of the racetrack to try to take the lead away from Truex.
And boy, in the top side, there's a lot of momentum up there. Truex got the lead back now with a lot of horsepower coming on that back straightaway out of that DEI engine. Right to the bottom of the racetrack. Now, guys, that's the fastest way around the track in the early going. Jamie?
Well, Rusty, it's awfully competitive out there for Martin Truex Jr. He just came over the radio a couple seconds ago to his crew chief, Bono. This is what he said.
Found a new line. I found a new line. Yeah, don't brag about it.
The team continuing to work, guys. They want a win here in these chase races. They want to move the top 10 in the points. So, hey, you found a new line. He's excited about it, but shh, don't tell anybody.
Yeah, we just told 8-9 million people just then, so that's something. But don't look now. That number two car, that blue deuce of Kurt Busch, that thing was flying yesterday in practice. That team's really excited about their chances today. They think they got a good shot to win this thing.
They brought a strong horse, talking about the two car, the Penske car of Kurt Busch, same car that dominated at Pocono, leading 175 of 200 laps. They nicknamed the car the PT Special after a crew chief, Pat Thrysen, who assembled this car and made it a contender every time it's been on the racetrack.
Got a few laps on the tires now. You see that 42 car of Juan Pablo Montoya kind of searching up the racetrack a little bit. That's where he got really good in that first run, moving up on that top lane.
Yeah, that last time by, the speed, a 29.60 second lap. Oh, caution flag out in the racetrack, guys.
Caution for the fourth time here. We just have 35 laps thus far. A little yellow fever here. Another piece of debris off of the Jeff Burton car again. Piece of sharp metal coming out from under the car.
Looks like maybe he's losing a few more panels out from under that car.
Okay, guys, this isn't the same replay, is it? He's just losing more metal. Here's the rest of it coming out right now. Whoa. Now that's definitely the side panel behind the right rear tire that seals off everything to the fuel cell area.
Jeff Burton, the only two-time winner at Texas Motor Speedway, losing parts and pieces here early on today. Under caution for the fourth time. Back in a moment. Welcome back to the Dickies 500. Pit stops the order of the day under caution number four. Let's go down to Mike Massaro.
And Doc, on Matt Kenseth's first pit stop, he made a two-tire change, went with right sides. This time, another two-tire change, but this time the left sides. Jamie?
And Martin Truex Jr. saying he's a little bit tight. Air pressure adjustment, four tires. And Martin Truex is down and away.
Jimmy Johnson, left side tires going on. The current Cup champion, second points. A little frustrating head shake by a couple of guys on that crew. Here's the race off of pit road. Kenseth up a spot. Remember, he only took those two left side tires. Kurt Busch back one. David Gilliland, good job for the Yates team. Up four positions. Working caution for the fourth time a day here. As Jeff Gordon is the leader, here's the 31 car of Jeff Burton as they're pulling some of that sheet metal away. Remember, he had that little contact with the wall, and he's been losing some parts and pieces. And that's the reason they've had the last two caution flags, because of debris out of the back of this Chevrolet.
Now we've got a neat little thing developing right here, because some of these guys pitted about four laps ago under that last caution, and they stayed out here. So we've got this field shuffled. It's going to be interesting when we go green.
Jeff Burton will be down and away. We'll come back with a restart at Texas in just a moment. Welcome back to Texas Motor Speedway. Under caution for the fourth time today. Many of the cars came onto pit road. The top five cars did not pit. Jeff Gordon, Juan Pablo Montoya, Kevin Harvick, Dale Earnhardt Jr., and J.J. Yaley stayed on the racetrack. As the green flag waves, Gordon will lead him back down. Andy, you shook your head when you say Gordon did not come in. Why?
I think it's a bad call right there, because he's still got the same left side tires he started the race on. These other guys, Kyle Busch, some of these guys behind just pitted. They got four tires, and then this last stop, the rest of the field got four tires. He's got the worst tires in the field right now.
Well, Andy, I got to agree with you. I don't think that was a good call, not putting four tires on. I believe his car looked awful tight to me. It looks like he could run for four or five laps, and then the front end would take off on, and he was falling backwards. I was just getting ready to say before the crash happened, he is running 0.4 seconds slower than the top three guys. So it's yet to be seen what's going to happen with him.
This five car right here has got four tires that he got, you know, back on lap 31 when we had that yellow. He's got good tires, better tires than the 42 and a lot better tires than the 24.
This is third and fourth position, looking back from Kevin Harvick, who's in second spot. As you see Kyle Busch going by, taking the third spot away. Harvick has not led today. He would like to get up there and catch Jeff Gordon and get those five bonus points for leading a lap. And how about the eight car? Dale Earnhardt Jr. now moving in. He's in the fifth spot, moving in on Montoya for four.
And he was really happy with his car yesterday in practice. Dale Jr. was. He said, I can work the bottom of the track, the middle of the track, the top. Although, he's our in-race reporter, and he told us he's got to be a little careful off the corners and be very cautious running that high lane like he's used to running.
41 of 334 laps in the books. Jeff Gordon did not pit. His last pit stop was on lap 17. Folks, let's listen into the radios.
Cautions are saving us because we're pretty decent for a couple laps.
It just gets way too tight, right? All on throttle.
Yeah, down there at 3 and 4, it's before I pick up the throttle. Down there 1 and 2, seems like it turns pretty good for me until I pick up the throttle.
And that was the discussion under the caution flag just a moment ago between Jeff Gordon and his crew chief, Steve Letarte. Now, Jeff Gordon got track position. He's leading. He's in clean air. Jimmy Johnson, meanwhile, got four tires. He's way back in 27th position and a lot more in the danger zone right now if something should happen on the racetrack. As Steve Letarte tells me, it's going to be track position all day for their strategy.
Well, you can't beat track position, that's for sure, as long as your car's handling good. So Jeff Gordon's looking good in a moment, but that change of not putting anything on, not changing anything at all, Andy, that's still got me concerned.
Well, the other thing he's got to worry about is if this thing stays green, he's going to have to pit for fuel a lot sooner than the rest of these guys.
Now, that is a major concern right there. When you're out there in a racetrack and you've got to pit for fuel and they're going, you're going to go laps down, and that's a tough one.
Back here, back, that's Casey Mears, who pitted the 9 car back there as well. Casey Kane. J.J. Yaley, one of the cars that did not come on the pit road. Remember back in the spring, guys, when Jimmy Johnson was caught in an accident early on because he was back in traffic and ended up getting a 38th place finish? That's what Alan Bessick was alluding to, is that Jimmy Johnson right now is mired back in 25th position. Meanwhile, up front, Kyle Busch. You talked about the four fresh tires the 5 car has. He's gone by the 29 and now sets his sights on his teammate, Jeff Gordon.
I'm still real surprised that this 24 car is able to stay out in front of these guys with the tires he's got. This 5 car's got four brand new tires, about 15 laps newer. I'm surprised that Gordon's able to hold this lead.
More on Kevin Harvick. Let's check in with Mike Massaro.
You know, Doc, I spoke with Harvick's crew chief, Todd Barrier, this morning. He says whenever they come to a mile-and-a-half racetrack, they're always a little bit leery, but this weekend they have reason for optimism. We'll get to that in a minute, but there's a battle for the lead shaping up right now as Kyle Busch sweeps by Jeff Gordon.
Yeah, not much of a battle at all because Gordon couldn't do much. Kyle Busch just went flying, went sailing right by.
Well, he was really screaming. Now, take a look at Kevin Harvick on top of the racetrack right here. That was our winner yesterday in the Busch Series event. And, Mike, he looked really good yesterday.
And that's pretty much what I talked to Todd Barrier about. That's the reason they're so optimistic. Todd told me any time that Kevin runs well in the Busch car, it seems to really translate to his Cup car. Even looked historically into his record books. He said when he won the 2001 and 2006 Busch Series championships, those were his best years in the Cup cars, and statistically that's true. Those are the only 2 years he had multiple Nextel Cup wins. Now, as you alluded to, he won yesterday. He's looking for the weekend sweep. If he picks up the weekend sweep, that'll be the fifth time in his career he's done that. That would be a new NASCAR record.
Kevin Harvick's sixth Busch win of the season yesterday, 32nd career win, which is a landmark for Amicus, him second all-time in Busch career wins, NASCAR Busch Series career wins, behind only Mark Martin.
Right now, those four tires for Kyle Busch are really working. He's just flat sailing out there. About 0.3 seconds faster at the moment than Jeff Gordon. And really, Kevin Harvick's only about 0.1 seconds faster. It's probably a matter of time before he finally does get around Gordon.
looks like they got this five car fixed up pretty good. He tagged the wall a little bit in practice yesterday, and the guys had to work on it and kind of straighten it back out, but they've got it fixed pretty good, looks like.
Yeah, I walked past her yesterday, Andy, and they had the spindles off it. They were beating the fenders out, and Dave, that was a tore-up car yesterday.
The five car right now of Kyle Busch, Rusty, leading this race, and after yesterday finishing second, had a chance to check in with crew chief Alan Gustafson this morning. Said after the race yesterday, I had a good 20-minute debrief with Kyle. We had a contentious day. We didn't win the race, but we reasoned that we had a good race car today, and we worked on how to make it better for today, both communication-wise and mechanically. And so far, they're doing well, now leading this race.
Left side of your screen, Jimmie Johnson going by the 07 of Clint Bowyer. And here goes the 29 of Harvick by the 24 of Jeff Gordon. Harvick, we talking about, you just heard a moment ago how when he has a good day in the Busch car, he has a really good day in the Cup car the next day. That might be working for him because he won yesterday and now running second today. Here is Jimmie Johnson continuing his march back toward the front. 48 car now going by Tony Raines to take away the 20th position. And Bowyer, by the way, how good is Clint Bowyer? Hanging right there in third spot. And folks, with the right things happening Boyer's way today, he could leave here as the points leader.
Well, Jerry's doing the same thing he's done all year long. He's consistent. He's working on his car every practice session, every pit stop. And right now, the car looks good. Johnson's a little bit quicker than him right now, but Bowyer's doing what he's got to do, just hanging in there at the moment.
Seems like that's what Bowyer's done all year, and in this chase especially. He's just hang right in there. And these guys have been good.
Kyle Busch setting sail in the 5 car. We knew the Hendrick cars would be good. We thought it would be 48 and 24, but here's the 5 car at the front of the field as he was late a week ago at Atlanta, but it didn't work his way. Maybe he's going to make up for it today here. Lap 52 complete. Kyle Busch, a leader. You're watching ESPN on ABC. Beautiful aerial shots from high above Texas Motor Speedway, courtesy of our good friends at Goodyear, the official tire of NASCAR, helping NASCAR drivers get to the finish line for over 50 years. This broadcast is available in Spanish by activating your SAP button presented by ESPN Deportes. Listen to the Spanish coverage of our NASCAR Nextel Cup chase for the Cup here at Texas Motor Speedway. Let's take you up to speed here on the leaders as we head down and listen in to what's happening with Kyle Busch, starting with Dave Burns.
Well, Doc, the lead story last week was when Kyle Busch had trouble on pit road at the end of the race. I talked to Alan Gustafson about that, and he said, this week I made a move I hate to make, moves you hate to do as a crew chief. I had to take Rick Pidgeon off the jack and put Scott Radle on. So Scott Radle will replace Rick this week and for the coming days if they choose so. It wasn't a move they wanted to make, but they said we needed to try something to try to keep ourselves in contention at the end. Mike?
Well, guys, earlier we mentioned how Kevin Harvick typically races better on Sunday when he has a good performance in the Busch car on Saturday. Here's one example of how it's helping him today. On his first round of pit stops, Todd Barrier suggested that they pull a spring rubber. Kevin Harvick came over the radio and said, no, I'd rather you don't do that. Instead, let's make an air pressure adjustment. His rationale was the car is reacting much the way it was Saturday afternoon, so he made the same change they made yesterday. Let's go to Alan.
And Dale Earnhardt Jr. has just taken a spot away from Jeff Gordon and moved himself up to the number three position right now. Jr. talked about shattering the right front tire of his car when he's in traffic. But right now, he's not in traffic. That's clean air going to the nose of that Chevrolet. Jeff Gordon dropping back to fourth. His crew chief, Steve Letard, has played strategy twice to take the lead of this race. Jeff talking about his car struggling there to the center of the corner with front grip and from that point off the corner with back grip. Jamie?
Tell you what, one guy who's flying out there that nobody's been talking about is Casey Kane. He won here 1 year ago. It's been over a year since he's won a race. He loves his car, and he just told us on the radio, told his crew chief, he's getting great momentum off the turns, and that's what it's all about. We got to watch Casey Kane. He's gained 20 positions. Now, right behind him, Martin Truex Jr. started on the pole, slipped back to six. Now, on that last pit stop, the team originally was scheduled to put on four tires. Well, the benefit of being in the number one pit box, you can just see what everybody else does. They made that last-minute call, took two right-side tires for track position. And right behind him, actually back just a little bit, he is a chase contender, Kurt Busch. He's in that PT special you heard Dr. Punch talk about. Now, this is a car who's dominated. It dominated at Pocono, and then it went on and dominated at Michigan. So here they're looking for big things. They're going for the win. They kind of count themselves out of the championship contention, but they want to win here today. Dave?
J.B. Reed Sorensen makes his fourth start here at the Texas Motor Speedway. The car has been tough to handle off of the corners all race. Wants to push toward that wall. He pitted on lap 16 with everybody and on lap 30, made air pressure adjustments both times. He got track position back when most pitted on lap 37, and he stayed out, Alan.
Juan Pablo Montoya led this race from lap 7 to 16, but on the pit stops there at lap 16, his team took four tires when others took two, so that shuffled him back in traffic. He hasn't gotten back to the front yet. Montoya right now running in ninth position. Jamie?
And Denny Hamlin, Nick Hamlin as well. They took four tires. They thought that was the best thing to do. They started seventh, running pretty strong. Denny Hamlin, though, early on, it looked like he got into A.J. Allmendinger. Allmendinger came over the radio and said, no, Denny had nothing to do with it. So Denny's car is good. Looking for a win.
Great update, folks, down there with the leaders as you take a look at the 42 and the 11 side by side for ninth position. Montoya getting a challenge by Denny Hamlin.
Well, Denny Hamlin's car yesterday in practice, guys, was really strong all through that session. And Montoya, he's really falling off right now, guys.
Well, what you're seeing right there is just a 17-lap difference in tires in those two cars. Now, Dale Earnhardt Jr. and his 29 car, Harvick, you know, Jr. pitted back on 17, and so did Harvick. These guys are the ones that have really held their track position pretty well with those tires.
And Dale Earnhardt Jr. told you when you talked to him, I'm going to run the high groove, and that's where he has gone, up to the high groove. And he is sailing up there toward the outside as he goes by the 29 car. Take a look at our sprint speed lap for Dale Earnhardt Jr. last time by 171.369 miles per hour. And the leader's last lap, just over 170.2 for Kyle Busch.
Yeah, so he's found a home up there right now. Dale Earnhardt Jr. has. He's just flat flying around the top of this racetrack. But what I always talk about, there's no room for error. He's only like a foot off the wall, and sometimes 6 inches at 200 miles per hour. So, man, he's got to be a little careful.
No guts, no glory. It looks like it's fast up there, so.
Well, I know you got to have guts. He's only 67 laps out of a 334-lap race, though, so he's got to have some brains, too. And he does. He just got to keep it in check.
Here are the Ford lap leaders thus far. Kyle Busch has now officially led the most laps thus far, 21. Jeff Gordon, 20. Truex, our pole sitter, 16. And Juan Pablo Montoya led once for 10 laps. Back after these messages and a word from our ABC stations. Back in Texas, Jeff Gordon.
Go ahead, let you go. 4,000. All the way to the cone. 4,000.
They're telling him the pit road speed. Jeff Gordon, 4,000 RPMs. That's 45 miles an hour. He had pitted last on lap 17. Stayed out when everyone else came in on lap 38, but he had to come in now for four tires.
Well, he was out of gas. He can only go about 55 laps on that tank of fuel, and that was a scheduled pit stop. He's kind of in trouble a little bit here waiting on these other guys to pit, because if the caution happens to come out now, he's in big trouble. A.B.
Well, that was the whole gamble, and everything that's up at stake now for Steve Letarte is waiting for this thing to cycle around for this race team and hope that the caution doesn't come out until everyone else is pitted. They have their track position. They've gained their bonus points for leading. Now they need a little luck for the next probably 20 minutes or so.
He's running 40th right now, one lap down, Alan. So he's a little vulnerable until these other guys make their pit stop.
And as of right now, Jimmy Johnson would be our points leader because of showing the fact that the 24 car was a lap down in 40th position. Here come the others who didn't pit before, the 8 car of Earnhardt Jr. and Kevin Harvick. Mike?
And Kevin Harvick looking for a little bit more forward grip, I should say. They're going to make an air pressure adjustment, a four-tire change in fuel on the 29 car. Let's go to Alan.
And Dale Earnhardt Jr. going to get a four-tire change. So he was just asking the crew about the shape of that front valence, that lower lip of that front air dam. So I don't know if Jr. hit something on the track, that debris that came off Jeff Burton's car perhaps, but we'll check that with Tony Gibson, the crew chief, in a minute.
Sure looks clean from here, Alan. I don't know if he's talking about maybe rubbing the racetrack and wondering if it's touching or not, but the valence looks good from here.
Juan Pablo Montoya, who had also stayed out on that previous yellow, coming in for four tires and fuel. Montoya has already led 10 laps today.
Montoya's car was really starting to fall back, so he was really looking for this pit stop to get four tires back on his car and get the handling back.
Well, we had four caution flags the first 35 laps, and the last thing that the 24 car needs right now for something to happen on the racetrack, else they're in serious trouble. Here's the 5 car, his teammate Kyle Busch, who's the leader. The 9 car of Casey Kane, running in second spot.
Andy, I want to throw a question out to you. We see the decision made by the 24 team not to stop on that initial caution. And you and I know, as we talked to Steve Letarte the other night, he really talked a lot about how much input Jeff Gordon has into the decision-making, what goes on. He's always trying to make Jeff comfortable. When you're talking about Chad Knaus, though, he is more demonstrative in what goes on with that race car. Which strategy or which guy do you favor as far as being a crew chief? Which style do you favor as far as trying to win a championship?
That's a good question, Brad. I probably was more like Chad Knaus in the fact that I was a little more high-strung, maybe intense, more technical. Steve Letarte's a laid-back, confident kind of person that, you know, he's got a little different style, but they both work very well, and these are great crew chiefs. Both of these guys are. This looks like, you know, Steve Letarte may be in a little trouble right now. If this thing cycles through, it may work out just fine for him, but that's why these guys make the big bucks down there, Brad.
Well, right now, it's just wait and see at the moment. I mean, if the caution comes out, Gordon's in trouble. If we stay green and everybody else has got to hit pit road, he's okay again. In fact, then if the caution comes out when he's leading, then the rest of them in trouble. So they're all sitting on his pit boxes right now just looking for stopwatches. And it's a big wait and see right now.
It has been since 2001 that Jeff Gordon won a Cup championship. This year, it seems to be different. We asked Jeff Gordon, what really is the difference this year with this whole team?
Some days you're on, some days you're off, but it's usually in the race car. It's usually in the race team, you know, and how well prepared they are, and you know, how in sync you are as a team. And I feel like that's been our biggest thing this year is that, you know, the chemistry, the communication, everything has just really been in sync this year.
All about being in sync, Steve Letarte, as you heard Brad Daugherty say. He listens to his driver, and he makes some of these gutsy calls. And right now, he's made a gutsy call. We just joined our coverage. Jeff Gordon pitted out of sync, stayed out on lap 38 when others came in to lead some more laps, and now has pitted and is a lap down in 38th position.
Steve Letarte sitting on that pit box, literally holding his breath, waiting for this two car or the one car to make their pit stop and start cycling through these other leaders. Then they'll be okay. But right now, they're sitting there a lap down, and he's literally holding his breath.
Meanwhile, the 48 car, Jimmy Johnson, right now being shown 79 points ahead of Jeff Gordon in the points lead. Lap 82, and here comes another car on the pit road. The car number 9 of Casey Kane, a bit out of sequence in terms of pit stops. Jamie Little.
And that's Casey Kane. He is just flying, worked his way up to second. They're going to take four tires, full fuel. Casey was questioning that sway bar adjustment on the last stop. He said he was just a little loose. Other than that, he's loving that number 9.
Casey Kane, as you heard Jamie say, he's the only driver to win at this racetrack from the pole. How about that for emotion coming out of the crew? These guys, they work hard, and they want to get them in. It's all about pride on the pit road.
It's right? All this adrenaline pump when you get out there and make that pit stop. You make it, and it's really good. You jump out on that pit road and go, yeah.
Man, they're pumped up, but there's a lot of guys out there really nervous right now. I mean, this is a tough time right now, waiting to see if the caution is going to fly, when the rest of them are going to pit. Here comes our leader.
Leader of the 5 car, Kyle Busch, trying to get it, whoa, down heavy on those brakes to get in the car inside to 45 miles an hour. He comes down behind Matt Kenseth. Down to you, Dave.
And Kyle Busch looking for his second victory of the season in this 5 car. Right now he's saying a lot of things about the car. Mostly it needs more turnability. That's one of Kyle's words today. Turnability for the car. They're going to do it with air pressure adjustments on these 4 tires. Before on, they have not been on pit road since lap 31. He gives up the lead. He's got fresh rubber now, guys.
Here's a 25, Casey Mears, same car he won with at Charlotte back in May. Alan?
Yeah, this team has played some strategy through the day, Doc. Darren Grubb, the crew chief, bringing Casey on for 4 tires at lap 16, just 2 tires at lap 28, and then no pit stop at lap 37. So this has been a long green flag run for this car. Casey working with front end grip, what he needs most. 4 tire stop there, just a touch slow.
Two car of Kurt Busch. You see Casey Mears coming off there as the leader, as Kurt Busch becomes the 5th different driver to lead this race here this afternoon. 2-time winner this year, won at Pocono in this car, also won at Michigan.
Pit this time.
Pit stops continuing here as Reed Sorensen comes down with a bandaged nose on his Dodge. Dave?
Rear grip is what the 41 of Reed Sorensen needs right now, so they're going to do that with air pressure. Tires all the way around for Sorensen. A good run so far today. Again, worked his way up through track position, having to give it up now for fuel and fresh tires.
Boy, right now, Jeff Gordon's loving all this stuff. These guys are all peeling off pit road, pitting, and it's starting to cycle around back to him right now.
By the way, you Johnny Sauter fans, he got a pass-through penalty for too fast exiting on pit road. Here comes the 48 car, Jimmy Johnson, who is now our points leader on pit road, slowing down 45 miles an hour. Let's see what Chad Knaus and his bunch will do. Jamie.
Well, Doc, remember 1 year ago, this is where he took over the points lead for good, winning his first championship. He's pulling into the pit box. Pretty happy with that car. They're going to do four tires once again. They're not going to take a gamble here. Fill her up with fuel. Jimmy Johnson, let's see how solid their stop is. It's all about pit road as well, guys, not just the performance on the racetrack. Jimmy Johnson down and away, 13.8. Doc.
Well, a great pit stop, sub 14 seconds in the heat, and that's a good pit stop, Andy.
Yeah, that was a great pit stop, and I saw a ton of brake dust coming out of those wheels off that 48. Allen.
And here comes Tony Stewart in, giving up what was an eighth place run at the moment for a four tire change. Trying to work on the front end grip on his car. You see the wrench in the back right rear, a little adjustment. Well, actually, you don't, out that nose camera shot. But a four tire change here for the 20 car. Front end grip is what this Arnage machine needs.
Man, we have got a fleet up hitting pit road. They're all coming down. And here comes the one car. He's going to pit here just shortly from Martin Truex.
Jamie?
Making that long drive all the way down to the number one pit box for Martin Truex Jr. Last stop, they opted to take right sides only so they could get that track position. They came in second. You see him do right sides there. They are going to opt and take those left sides as well, change those out. He said he's real loose getting into three. The conditions are changing a bit out here, guys, as the sun starts to set. And Martin Truex is down the way.
Truex, who was our pole sitter and led early on twice for 16 laps, gets his stop. Here is the 11 car, Denny Hamlin, on pit road, one of our chasers. And Dave, let's go in the 07 pits.
Clint Bowyer trying to make this car good enough to win today. Right now, no changes requested from the driver, just fresh rubber, a full tank of fuel, but nothing done to the chassis. He's happy the way it's driving right now.
Bowyer coming in just 111 points out of the lead, and now it is shuffled. As these pit stops take place, there's the Jeff Burton team coming down. Right behind him is teammate Clint Bowyer, two of the drivers that are in our chase for the Nextel Cup. Leader still is a two-car of Kurt Busch. He has yet to pit, and on cue, here he comes slowing down to 45, and he will make his scheduled stop.
Look at the right front wheel on Kurt Busch's car. All these guys are using their brakes really hard. We'll have to check on that, see what's going on. But a lot of brake dust, like Andy's been talking about.
Kurt Busch headed all the way down the pit road, and that right front wheel is not blue. It is black because of the brake dust. Jamie.
And Kurt Busch in his box. I talked to Roger Penske, the owner, earlier, guys. He had some interesting words about potentially swapping the points from this two car to enable Sam Hornish Jr. to run full-time and come next year. We'll get back to that later on, but it's going to be a four-tire stop and no changes. He's down at 13.1.
Thank you, Jamie. And now with these pit stops cycling, Steve Letarte can take a deep breath because his driver, Jeff Gordon, is back on the lead lap.
Yeah, that's the cars he was looking to come down pit road. He can breathe a little bit, but now they've got to go in another cycle. And Jeff Gordon probably gained a lot of track position by that early pit stop, but he'll start losing some of that now as these guys have fresher tires.
All the way up to fourth position. He was down as far as 40th after coming in, after staying out and to run to lead some laps and then coming in and going a lap down. Kyle Busch, our leader, Dale Earnhardt Jr. second, Harvick, Jeff Gordon, and Casey Kane in the top five after 93 laps. Back in a moment. Kyle Busch hanging on to the lead here at Texas Motor Speedway. Lap 100 of 334. 234 laps to go along with Andy Petrie, Rusty Wallace. I'm Jerry Punch. Glad to have you with us. And Kyle just trying to hang on. He's made pit stops. That's Ricky Rudd back there behind him. Ricky making his final start in his illustrious 32-year career. His 904th career NASCAR Nextel Cup start. Ricky will call it quits when the 2000 season is over.
Man, take a look at that 8 car right dead against the wall again. Andy, there's no room for error where he's running, but he is running fast where he's running. He's in second right now and picking up on the leader.
I think there's a lot to be gained by running that high line, especially if you got the car set up for it. You can carry all that momentum. It is risky, but hey, man, he just wants to win a race.
Well, I agree with you. Allen.
You know, there's a lot of pressure on this race team to get a win before this season's out, Rusty, and it's pressure they're putting on themselves. Tony Gibson, the crew chief, told me this morning that they, you know, you've heard Junior talk about it a lot, but he said, we really want to get him to victory lane before he leaves DEI. This team is all behind him. We all support him. We're sorry to see him go, but we really want to win one more time together. We're putting a lot of pressure on ourselves to make that happen. He said, I hope we don't put too much pressure on ourselves. Because, you know, sometimes that pressure leads to mistakes.
And Alan Dale Earnhardt Jr. has won at least one race in each of his first seven seasons in NASCAR Nextel Cup. And, folks, he's got three chances to keep that streak alive. Whoa! And, that was a close chance to keep the car going. Let me get my heart started again here as he hangs on and Bobby Labonte goes by. Well, what a job up high.
Let's take a look at this one more time. I got to see this one more time. I mean, that was one big wiggle there on the bottom of the track, going up to the wall. Now, let's see what happens. Boy, he starts getting loose before he even got up there. Whoa, that right rear quarter almost got that wall.
Well, good save. You're talking about how risky it is up top. He was on the bottom of the racetrack right there.
Yeah,
I think if I'm him, I'm going back up top.
Well, I got a feeling he was heading to the top when that happened. So, tough to you, Alan.
Well, that whole problem started because Junior's struggling with front end grip in the center of turns 3 and 4. He said the car started off with the back end being a little out of control, but now it's the front end grip in 3 and 4 that he's fighting, and that was probably that slide up off that corner that started him out of control toward that wall and when things started to go a little crazy there a second ago. Huh, Rusty?
Well, he'll be aware how much room he's got right now and how his car's handling. You see, he's right to the bottom of track again now. Looks like he's a little nervous to go up the top of the track at the moment. Gonna have to rebuild his confidence right now.
Guys, guess what? Here come the teammates together again. It should be a song, 24 and 48. Hendrick Motorsports teammates, Jimmy Johnson, now trying to go by Jeff Gordon. That would be for seventh position. And right now, Johnson is 18 points behind Gordon in the standings.
There again, what you're seeing right here is the difference in their tires. The 48 car's got about 20 less laps on his tires than the 48. And you're going to see this 24 car slip back as this run goes on. And then when they make that pit stop, he can make up that ground, make it back up again. But it's just going to be a seesaw thing until these guys get back in sync.
Well, I guarantee it, Jeff Gordon's thinking right now, I wish the caution flag would come out so we get these things back in sync. We get some fresh tires.
I mean, I'm pushing, but the back end ain't worth a darn.
So he's talking about the front end pushing, the front end sliding, but the back of the cars is not holding on too good either.
24 car slipping and sliding a little bit. The 48 car setting sail now. He is gone or trying to move in, gone by the 29.
It's rolling through the corner better than it was, but the front end still not far off of what it was before.
As he goes by Kevin, all right, let's check in Jimmy Johnson's pit with Jamie.
And what a hustle back he's done. You know, they took those four tires early on and lost a lot of track position, but he's back up to seventh right now, and he's not real comfortable with the way the car is handling. Chad Kanowski came over the radio and told Jimmy, try a little front brake and it'll help the car settle down a little. Rusty, what good would that do to the car right now?
Well, I mean, that's bad news, I think, if you're going to start adjusting your brakes. I mean, this is a track where you don't use hardly any brake whatsoever. But obviously, the guys are using more than they're used to. Because as Andy Petrie showed, I mean, we're getting a lot of brake dust, Andy, on these cars right now. So these guys are really struggling with these brakes.
If you look at these lap times on the board, their fastest lap to their current laps, there's about 2 seconds difference in this fall off. And I think these guys just have to, as the run goes on, they have to slow the car down so much more that they're using a ton of brake.
Jimmy Johnson won this cup title a year ago, but it was an intense pursuit for Jimmy. A lot of stress, a lot of pressure on him. We asked Jimmy about the difference this year, about maybe being just a little bit more relaxed.
The hunger and desire is there to be a champion again. My work ethic and commitment is still the same, but I'm not losing sleep at night. I'm well rested, I'm enjoying life, and I think I'm operating from a better place than the frustrated, pressure-packed situation I was in last year. So I feel I'm a better race car driver today, more mature driver, and more of a threat for championships and race wins than I've ever been in my career.
Man, with 8 victories, I guess he is sleeping good.
Jeff Gordon and Jimmy Johnson dominant here in NASCAR Nextel Cup. Look, since 2002, Jimmy Johnson, 31 wins, one cup title, trying to get the second one. By the way, Jeff Gordon trying to get number 5.
ESPN's coverage of NASCAR Nextel Cup Series on ABC. Brought to you by Chevy, an American Revolution.
An absolutely beautiful day to go racing here at Texas Motor Speedway. A huge crowd on hand. They know the Dallas Cowboys don't play until tonight, so they've come out to watch the chase continue for the Nextel Cup. And what a game of cat and mouse we've had unfolding here today. Jeff Gordon and Jimmy Johnson, 9 points apart. Remember Chad Knaus last week in Atlanta? Remember that late pit stop, two tires, and Jimmy was able to take the lead and win again. Today it was Jeff Gordon and Steve Letarte. They strategized early. They went out. They grabbed the clean air. But lately, as you watch these two, Jimmy Johnson seems to have the better car of the two. He seems to be able to pull up on Jeff whenever he wants to. We'll see how this unfolds the rest of the afternoon. Remember, they just want to stay within striking position. Then the last 50, 60 laps, they'll go for the W here at Texas. Back on top, we go to the dock.
Thank you, Brent. Take a look at these two crew chiefs. Now, Chad Knaus is like he is. Trouble on the front straightaway. The 18 car of Yaley is spinning down in the grass, and that will definitely bring out caution number 5 on the afternoon.
And this is just what Jeff Gordon wanted, because he was losing about a half a second to teammate Jimmy Johnson. Johnson was flying. Kurt Busch was really flying. And now this is going to put everybody back together on the same fuel strategy, the same tire strategy. And Andy, that's probably pretty comforting for Jeff Gordon.
And Steve Letarte. Steve Letarte's sitting there going, "Woo! I'm glad to see that caution."
Yeah, we were watching Steve and Chad Knaus talk as Brent was surmising everything that was happening here, and you see how stoic and how focused Chad Knaus was. He was hardly blinking an eye. And whereas Steve Letarte was sort of turning around, talking to people and mouthing different comments to different people on the box, different personalities. Now, let's show you what happened here to bring out the caution number 5 on the afternoon. Here comes the 18 car of Yaley.
Boy, that is just a classic case of getting loose. He tried to chase it, overcorrected, but he did the right thing by just getting the wheel to the left and spinning it out, not hitting the wall. So good job out of J.J. Yaley under a bad circumstance.
J.J. wanting to have a good run here. His sponsor, Interstate Batteries, is a Dallas-based company. Longtime sponsor in NASCAR for Joe Gibbs. They won a championship with Bobby Labonte. Here's the Chevy Pace car that right in front of Kyle Busch, the leader's car. It's Busch, Earnhardt Jr., Kurt Busch, Hamlin, Truex, and Jimmy Johnson. Those are the top 6 right now.
We're going to lift the hood up and look at everything in the front. Bobby, keep us posted on the pace car. Boys.
Carl Edwards had stopped on the racetrack. He was actually behind the leader when the caution came out, so he stopped to get back in his position.
Looks like he might have stayed in the throttle a little bit, trying to get past the 5 car, hopefully get back in the lead lap there, and NASCAR said no way.
Well, he's actually 2 laps down. He was trying to save one of those laps.
He's got to be feeling pretty good, though. At least he's got a championship under his belt right now. Not going away once and now, but it did yesterday when he wrapped up that series title.
Alan Gustafson, there's Chad Knaus, crew chief for Johnson, Steve Letarte for Gordon. Here they come, and we'll cover it in the pits. Dave Burns.
Leader pitting, car too tight. Jason Jones, rear tire carrier, will make an adjustment, track bar adjustment, to try to loosen up that race car. They will take on 4 tires. Alan.
And Jeff Gordon in that middle box on the left-hand side. They're going to give up a little track position here. They're pitting from 7th, but when they come around to the left side of the car, they're going to take the time to pull a spring rubber out of the left rear. That might cost them a couple of spots. Jamie.
And Chad Knaus reminding his driver, 4,200 RPM coming down pit road. It's going to be 4 tires. He said he feels pretty good. He's free into 3, but he's able to use that throttle, and that's what it's all about. They're going to make a small wedge adjustment for our current leader, 14.7 seconds, Jimmy Johnson.
Race off of pit road, Kyle Busch, Truex gains a couple of spots, Harvick up 3 position, Earnhardt Jr. back 2. Under caution for the 5th time, back with a restart in a moment. Welcome back to Texas Motor Speedway here in Fort Worth, Texas. Under caution for the 5th time today, coming out lap 118, J.J. Yaley spin. Here is Jeff Gordon's car number 24 as we listen to his onboard radio.
A nice rubber stub, gentlemen. Nice rubber stub. All right, buddy, that wasn't all big rubber. I'm just looking for just a little something that's only maybe 25 pounds. Just a little something to make it turn. I worked your air pressures around. They got that track right now, trying to give you some security. I agree with you, it's going to be different in traffic, but what we need to remember is we're only at lap 120. We got 214 to go. The sun is dropping. This place is going to change a whole lot.
Let's go down to our Chevy cutaway car in Tim Brewer.
Thanks, Jerry. Watch Steve Letarte's talking about, folks.
These are rubbers. One of them's a lot harder than the other one. So what Steve's wanting, he's wanting a piece of the rubber, not the whole thing, just about a third of it taken out of the spring. And that's what's going to free the car up from the center of the corner off.
Thank Jerry, you, Tim. Thank you very much. That rubber spacer goes in and makes the spring stiffer or harder and keeps the car up and obviously makes a difference in the driver change. For more information on spring rubbers, log on to ESPN.com, search word Auto Tech. Pace car is pulled away. Kyle Busch will lead him down to the restart here. 212 laps to go. It'll be lap 124 when they click by the start-finish line. Kyle Busch has led three times for 67 laps. It is him and then brother Kurt Busch in hot pursuit with Truex Earnhardt Jr. and Denny Hamlin in the top five.
Folks, one thing I remember, we had a time change last night. We rolled our clocks back an hour. And what does that mean? It means that this race is going to end at night. So this racetrack is going to change a lot, Andy. Cars are going to get tighter. And as a crew chief, they're probably going to work on them a lot.
That's why we heard Steve Letarte talking to Jeff Gordon to remind him of that fact, that it is going to get dark and it's going to get a lot different. But now what I like is we've got all these cars on the same tires. We can actually see who's got the best race car.
Does this track change gradually? We're seeing shadows begin to move across the racetrack as you watch this battle here. Or will it change abruptly when it gets dark and just gets cool?
Well, it's going to go through a few phases. Let's call it that. You know, the first, the one and two is in the shade now. And that'll transition over the racetrack. And I'd say it'll go through about two more phases before the end of the race.
And this racetrack always gets tight. Every single race we've ever seen, guys start losing their front ends. But never have we ever ended here at night that I can remember in a long, long time. And boy, that track really changes then.
Here's 6th, 7th, and 8th, looking back from Kevin Harvick's onboard camera in 6th spot. Jimmy Johnson in 7th, and here is Harvick trying to move in behind the 43 car, Bobby Labonte. He's being shown a lap down in 26th position. And right now, the 48 car of Jimmy Johnson would be 6 points back of the 24 car. In terms of because of 24, Gordon is back in 9th spot.
I think a change in track conditions, and I think of the 48 car Jimmy Johnson of Charlotte, North Carolina, that track is very, very sensitive to changes. And this team has been one of the best teams at adjusting to those track conditions.
Top of the ticker there, you see across the top of the screen there, the ticker shows you where the drivers are running. And the points in the chase, you see Carl Edwards in 6th spot. He has dropped 2 positions. He came into the day 4th in the points. And right now, Mike, he has lost 2 full positions in the chase standings.
And yeah, Doc, and Carl Edwards on top of the world coming into this race after wrapping up the Busch Series title yesterday. But the car, not to his liking whatsoever. At one point today, he radioed in and said, on a scale of 1 to 10, this is a 10 tight. It's unbelievable, he said. Bob Osborne's been working on it throughout the afternoon, but so far they have not been able to get it right.
They've got something wrong with this race car. This is not like missing the setup or they're just a little bit off. There's something wrong. They probably just don't have the time to look at it to see what it is, but they'll check this out tomorrow, and they'll find something wrong with this car.
You know, no matter what happens today, though, this has been a great weekend for Carl Edwards, a young man that went to the University of Missouri, grew up in Columbia, and, of course, yesterday here, Carl Edwards, who'd been chasing a dream, his 3rd year in the NASCAR Busch Series. He finished 3rd in the points his 1st year. There's his mom, Nancy Sterling. She knew how much her son wanted it. Well, his dream became a reality here at Texas Motor Speedway on Saturday afternoon. Jack Roush congratulating Pierre Cattell. Mom giving her son a kiss because he becomes the 2007 NASCAR Busch Series champion.
And what do they call this guy's occasionally? Going from a hero to a hobo, man. But at least he got the big one yesterday. He's 3 laps down. Poor guy is struggling big time today.
Jimmy Johnson now going by Kevin Harvick. He's not struggling at all. Johnson sails by to take the spot away. He's in 6th position. See Tony Stewart there as well. Remember, Tony Stewart ran so well here in this race a year ago. You know, in fact, Tony dominated here back last November. He led 278 laps. Time now for our AT&T Crew Chief Challenge. 4 chase drivers have previously won at Texas. Which chase driver with a previous win at Texas has the best chance to repeat here today? Could it be Jeff Burton, Carl Edwards, Matt Kenseth, or Tony Stewart? Well, trouble on the racetrack. Heavy contact with the 40 car all. And more contact. There's Bill Elliott and Kyle Petty. And remember, the owner points very critical to both those cars, the 45 and the 21.
There's the 40 car. Home Life Communities Dodge for David Stremme. And boy, he has had some serious contact there driving for Chip Ganassi and Felix Sabatis. Stremme thought this would be a good run for him. Same car, he had a top 10 finish at Charlotte back earlier in the year.
And boy, that car's been running good throughout the day. It's a shame that happened. He was really hoping for a good run here today, but boy, what a pile up down here. See a lot of smoke coming out of the back of David Stremme's car, indicating an engine problem.
He's got a left rear tire flat right here. Man.
Oh, he goes up and just gets the side of Kyle Petty right in front of the 21 of Elliott. He has nowhere to go.
It looked like he was going to be fine and get the car down on the apron, and then the car just took a dead right.
I mean, boy, you go up in a racetrack and the car's coming at you at over 200 miles per hour. He had no chance, and these guys got wiped out because of it. Kyle. Right on the bottom of the track on the apron, a dirty portion, and loses it.
Kyle Petty trying to hang on to a top 35 spot in owner's points. He was 34th coming into here. Oh, there's the car going right up across the racetrack into Kyle Petty's door. Now, let's show you why David Stremme had a tire going down. Watch the contact. Is there contact? A little bit of rubbing there between he and Tony Raines? Might have happened just before that when those guys got together. Let's watch here again.
Actually, see, he's struggling right now. You can see the tire is actually soft at this point. And even though they do have contact, I believe that tire was going down before they ever touched.
Yeah, that was an incredible shot. You saw the left rear tire going flat on the number 40 car, David Stremme. And, guys, you can't hold on too long when that happens.
Well, the reason Chad's looking like that is that 48 car was really coming in.
Speaking of coming in, they all are, Dave.
And Kyle Busch will lead them down. They'll put on two right side tires only. Slight chassis adjustment, a little bit of a tight race car at the start of the runs, Alan.
And center frame on the left side of the screen, Jeff Gordon going to make an adjustment on this car and also would take four tires on the stop. There was talk of two. They're going to go for four, Jamie.
And Jimmy Johnson, the bottom of your screen, right side tires only. Jimmy said this car is not bad. Let's keep with it, guys. He's down and away.
Well, guys, now Jimmy Johnson takes two right sides only. There's Harvick up a spot. You see Jeff Burton up two. Jimmy Johnson down one because of taking tires and taking his time getting on pit road. There's Boyer up a couple of positions. Under caution for the sixth time today. Heavy contact. Kyle Petty, Bill Elliott, Davis Trimmy. You're watching ESPN on ABC. Back at Texas Motor Speedway, glad to have you with us. Under caution here for the sixth time this afternoon. Pretty hard contact. David Stremme has a tire going down. His car goes up across the racetrack, contacts Kyle Petty, and he gets hit by the 21 car of Bill Elliott. Let's check in where Mike is caught up with David Stremme.
And it was a left rear tire that went down. You're right, Doc. And what was it like being in that car for that experience?
That's like the second week in a row we've had a tire go down. That one I kind of knew after the restart. For a couple laps, it was a little squirmy, and we were coming into pits, and I got to the apron, and the left rear blew out and then slid up, and it was unfortunate for Bill and Kyle. They got involved, but just one of them couple weeks. We had a right rear blow last week, now left rear blows. I think the tire fairy needs to help us out a little bit, so we'll see what goes on.
And Doc, as you can see behind David, the team going to work on the 40 car, a lot of damage on the front end of that car. David, not so sure they're going to be able to get this thing back in the race.
Thank you, Mike. I'll try to get him back out while we're under caution. Let's check in with our in-race reporter. By the way, Dale Earnhardt Jr., Ryan Newman, Casey Mears, all three of those guys staying on the racetrack did not pit under this latest caution. Earnhardt Jr. is the leader.
Dale Jr., Rusty Wallace, ESPN, you got us?
Yeah, Rusty.
Hey, buddy, looks like the track's really getting shaded down to 1 and 2, and looks like this race is going to end at night. Is your car chart starting to change big time on you?
Well, it ain't changed a whole lot. It's been nowhere near where I wanted to drive. After about 10 laps, I get so loose in. It's like just wildly loose in. And the thing just has this nice, slow, lazy plow up off the corner, and that's aggravating as heck. But we've been working on it, and I can match everybody on the top side after 25 laps, but we can't go nowhere to start, and that's what's going to take. We got to get our car a little better.
Dan, what's the deal on the tires? Looks like they're holding up pretty good, but you elected to stay out. What was the reason on that?
I just do what I'm told. I'd like to get tires every time I get tires. But, you know, sometimes the track position is important, and, you know, that's how we got up here anyway. So we'll take a couple 5 points to lead some laps anyway. So it's all right. We'll hold our own. We probably get passed by a couple guys on new tires, and we'll be all right.
All right, buddy. You and your team are doing a great job today, man. We'll check in with you later, okay?
Hey, Tony Gibson, Andy Petrie, you got a copy?
Yeah, go ahead.
Hey, Tony, when you hear all these, I hear him talking about the problems that he's having. What kind of changes do you think you're going to make here?
We've been doing some air pressure stuff to try to help him out. We haven't done a very good job so far today. We've been, like I say, we've been real loose. Those guys got a lot of grip. They take off and leave us at the start. He has to drive his butt off to try to keep up. So after a few laps, you know, we stabilize and get a little better, but we're just we got to do a better job of giving him something to drive at the start of the run.
10-4, Tony. This track position ought to help for a little while, and looks like Junior's doing you a great job out there.
Yeah, he's doing a really good job. I know it's a handful, and he's doing good. We're just trying to keep that track position. You know, we get back there in that back, and it really starts to plow pretty bad. So hopefully we can hang in here and stay in the top 5 or 10 here and get this thing figured out so he can go at the end.
Okay, guys, good luck out there.
Dale Earnhardt Jr., our leader, staying on the racetrack, and the Kurt Busch, the 2 car, coming in again, Jamie.
Well, they had some bad luck, Doc. They came in for their pit stop, went out, and they had a left flat. So they came in, they changed that. Now they're taking this spring rubber out. He needs more changes. He says, what the heck, we have nothing to lose. So they're going to take that spring rubber out of the right rear and change that tire. So Kurt Busch trying to hang in there, Susie, and change up his car for the changing conditions.
Jamie, we've got the Lone Star State Showdown. Only 3 races to go in the chase for the Nextel Cup. Our story in the FedEx race rundown. And NASCAR rookie Juan Pablo Montoya started 3rd. And with the fast start, he led his very first laps at a super speedway. How impressed are you?
Oh, I'm extremely impressed with Montoya. He's come so far so quickly this season.
And Jeff Gordon, well, he's got all these guys breathing down his neck. They're working so hard on strategy. What do you think?
Well, he's not won multiple championships for no reason, but he is trying to out-strategize. He tried to get an early lead, give himself a chance to get some bonus points, play out the cautions. I think he's done a good job thus far.
And the battle has raged. Gordon, Jimmy Johnson, at the moment separated by just 7 points.
Yeah, they're right on top of each other as we thought they would be, racing neck and neck. We're waiting on one of these guys to make a mistake to give the other an advantage.
Kyle Busch has led the most laps. In fact, this is a track he struggled on in the past, so that's a good sign, but maybe a little bit too late. We'll be back in Texas in just a moment.
This telecast is available on ABC HD, presented by DLP HD TV. Massive 1,500-acre complex, Great American Speedway. You know it as Texas Motor Speedway. Glad to have you with us, getting set for the restart. It'll be lap 140 as they come down, and Dale Earnhardt Jr., who did not pit, will lead them down to the green flag. Behind him, Ryan Newman in the 12 car, and, of course, Casey Mears in 3rd position. The first car that did take tires back in 4th position, that's Kyle Busch in the 5.
See, Elliott Sadler trying to hold on there in the 19 car. He's at the tail end of the lead lap right now. He doesn't want to give that up, hoping for a caution.
3 wide getting in turn 3 here.
How's it getting racing?
Bobby Labonte also there in the 43 car. He's the first car lap down in 24th position. Here's Earnhardt Jr. trying to move on the inside of Ricky Rudd.
That track's getting dark down into 1 right now. The sun's starting to set. A lot of grip because of that. Well, that sure does change the handle in the car. Look at Kyle Busch on the bottom of the track right there. Ducked out, made a good pass on Ricky Rudd. Car got a little loose on him. That car's been free all day long, guys.
Earnhardt Jr. Talking about the fact that his car gets loose early on in runs. Here's Kyle Busch with the 4 fresh tires. He has now gone by Casey Mears to take the 3rd spot away. Moving in on Ryan Newman for 2nd position.
It'd be interesting to see how Kyle Busch's car runs, because he was leading the race real loose with the back end of the car hanging out. And now with the sun setting, that should really tune his car up better. Yeah, it should make it pretty neutral. Meaning the front end and the back end of the car sticking good.
That's typically the way the track goes when it gets cooler. The back end starts to get a little bit more grip. Seems like the front end may lose a little grip when that happens, but when you have a loose car, you want to see that track cool down.
Andy, not hard to figure this one. 4 tires versus no tires, and the 5 car goes right on by.
Yeah, no contest here. I mean, like I've always said, there's no tire like a new tire. Junior's doing okay. We got a caution here.
Well, 41 of Sorensen in the wall, 38 of Gilliland spins. Carl Edwards, you see his car slowing.
Man, that's 2 Chip Ganassi and Felix Zavadas. Teams out of the race right now with big damage. Reed Sorensen driving the number 41 there. A lot of damage. Looks like they're not going to be able to get that car back in for a long time.
David Gilliland and the Yates car, the 38 car. There's the heavy damage on the 41.
Here we're done, boys. He has dove in the fence there on the back stretch.
Good news is the window net is down, which means he's awake and alert. That's the sign of the safety crews. This is the same car, by the way, that he had a career best finish last week in Atlanta when he came home in third position in front of the home state folks there. He is from Peachtree City, Georgia. Here's what happened a moment ago to the 41 and 38.
Looks like they got together here, the 41 and the 38.
But it almost looks like the 38 car, David Gilliland, got loose, and Reed might have reacted to that, jumped out of the throttle, and the car got loose with him also. And he went around. I believe it was a chain reaction, Andy, because of what happened with the 38, David Gilliland.
Carl Edwards trying to snake his way through these cars. This is the view from onboard his Ford.
Inside the 78. You see it. Slow down, slow down. Just stop. Stop if you got to. You see him. You see him go high now. Go high. Come on, baby.
That's Bobby Hudson, the spotter for Carl Edwards, doing a great job right there moving Carl through that wreck.
There's Gilliland on and off, getting four fresh good years. The leaders have stayed on the racetrack. Kyle Busch has reassumed the lead. Newman, Earnhardt Jr., Mears, Denny Hamlin in the top five. Looking back at our leader from the onboard camera on our Chevy pace car. As we update the points right now, Jimmy Johnson would be our points leader. Actually, it would be just dead even there. Jeff Gordon, Jimmy Johnson tied. Clint Bowyer back 113 points. Back after these messages and a word from our ABC stations.
The coach may be new, but the faces are familiar. Led by Big Ben, the Steelers are back in a familiar spot, division leaders. It's been a troubled start for Baltimore. Can Ray and the Ravens turn things around? Steelers, Ravens for the division lead at 8:30 Eastern on ESPN's Monday Night Football.
A division battle coming up on Monday night. We've got a battle within a team itself here. Hendrick Motorsports team with the 24 car of Steve Letarte leading the way for Jeff Gordon. A.B.
Steve Letarte, I know we're on one to go. Assess your race so far.
Up and down. It got a little hairy there early. We got off sequence, and we were just fortunate the caution came in a timely manner to get us back on sequence with the leaders. But the DuPont Chevrolet's not bad. It's not great. You know, the track changes so much here in Texas that sun falls. We're hoping it'll be good at the end.
Steve told me a minute ago he can't wait for the sun to set, Jamie.
And Chad Knauss, that's what I was going to ask him about these ever-changing conditions. Chad, the way we're going with all these cautions, it's going to be dark. How much does that affect you guys?
It's going to affect us a whole lot if they don't turn the lights on, I can tell you that. It's going to be getting dark real soon. And, you know, I just don't understand why we've had this rash of cautions here throughout all these chase races. I wish we could get some green flag racing. I think that our car's really good. The guys have been doing a really good job on pit stops. Jimmy's been doing a great job on the track. We just need to race a little bit.
All right, they just want to go racing, Doc, so let's get back to it.
Let's get after it. Get this party started. Now, you see the shade now coming across as the sun beginning to move down here in the Texas sky. Much of this track now has been shaded here out of turn four all the way out over into turn two. As they come down, and the green flag will wave once again. Kyle Busch, who has led four times for now 81 laps, will lead him down. Behind him, Ryan Newman, Earnhardt Jr., and Casey Mears.
Boy, Junior gets a big run off of turn two, sailing down the back straightaway, clears all the lap traffic. Trying to run down the 12 car Ryan Newman right now. And it's three wide going into turn three right now. But Denny Hamlin on the top.
You see why Chad Knauss gets so frustrated, because they can't get in a rhythm. They want to just get in a rhythm, run this race, and get to the finish. And with all these wrecks, and you see these guys running three wide again down the front stretch, I can see why he's so frustrated.
How dark it got in the windshields as they came out of turn three to turn four, like someone just turned the lights out. Now they turn the lights back on here. You see Jimmy Johnson in the middle of this mess here. Got to be careful tiptoeing toward the front.
Rusty, how hard is that when you're driving through these, you know, these sun areas and then drive into the shade? Does it blind the driver? Is it hard to find your groove when you're looking at that?
No, absolutely. When you're driving in the sunshine, like right there, as the sun's peeking through the bleachers, Andy, it's very hard to see your line and check the problem out. But Andy, take a look at this right now. Jeff Gordon, he's in a lot of traffic back here right now, and this is not good for him. This is where a mistake could be made, maybe not of his own doing. If a car spins, He hasn't been in this much traffic all day long.
And so's the 07 of Clint Bowyer. So our top three contenders in the chase are in heavy traffic. Now Bowyer goes by Johnny Sauter on the outside. Jeff Gordon trying to hug the bottom of the racetrack. Remember, neither Gordon nor Johnson have ever won at this racetrack, and they both have had some horrendous finishes here. Johnson finished 38th because of getting caught up in a wreck back in traffic in spring. And we showed you the top of the show. Jeff Gordon has had two very hard licks at this track by being tapped back in traffic.
This is the kind of situation. I'm really glad I've got a veteran driver like Jeff Gordon. Here we got a problem with the 9 car, Casey Kane. He's got some contact here with the left front fender.
Well, it looks like he got into somebody, and the left front tire is flat. The left front fender's all bent in. Guys, we're still under green, and he's getting to the bottom of the track right now. He's going to lose a lot of time.
Yeah, he'll come on the pit road. We will not go caution at this point in time. There's no other debris on the track. Casey, the winner here, back in the spring of 06.
See these guys running three wide.
And he's been so
banging.
Andy, he's been so good all day long. It's a shame to see this happen to him. But Kyle Busch, man, we're back up front right now, and he's been strong. And look at those lap times. Folks, we got monitors up here in the booth right now. He's about 3.5 tenths faster than second-place car. I mean, that's smoking.
What about Ryan Newman? You talk about a driver who is really hungry to get back to victory lane. It has been 78 races, folks. New Hampshire in the fall of 2005. Over 2 years, this Ryan Newman has gone to victory lane. He is trying to get up there and run with Kyle Busch. There's the 9 car, Casey Kane now. Making a pit stop. We'll show you what happened here to him just a moment ago. Watch the contact with the 70.
Something's wrong with Johnny Sauter's car. He's just slipping back through the field, and we saw a lot of guys splitting him three wide. Casey Kane jumped on the outside of him there and kind of got into the right rear quarter panel.
And boy, Casey had a lot of momentum trying to get around the outside of Johnny Sauter in that 70 and just couldn't get slowed down. And that left front tire just went down like that, guys. That just blew out easy.
A little bit different body style. This is the car they had at Atlanta. Ran so well for Casey King. Here is Jimmy Johnson now going by the 29 of Kevin Harvick. That is for the 8th spot. What about Jeff Gordon? Well, he is being back shown back in 15th position, trying to reel in Juan Pablo Montoya.
Just got to navigate through all this traffic and be careful right now. This is the time of the race where the track is changing big time because of the sun going down. And they got to keep up with these chassis changes and keep these cars out of trouble.
As of right now, Jimmy Johnson has taken a 10-point lead over the 24 car of Gordon. Johnson in 8th, Gordon back in 15th.
Remember, the 48 car just took 2 tires on that last pit stop, so it's working pretty good for this 48 team.
I was talking earlier, Andy, about how good this team is right here, adjusting to the changing track conditions. And I wouldn't want to bet against Chad Knaus under these conditions, that's for sure.
25 car Casey Mears now closing in on Dale Earnhardt Jr. Earnhardt Jr. talking about how the car was just so loose early in runs, but after about 25 laps, the car really started to stabilize a little bit. Now he's just trying to hang on to that spot. Neither he nor Mears, remember, made pit stops.
Boy, when a car is loose and you got another one right on your bumper, it makes you looser, makes it worse. And so Dale did the wise thing and let the 25 car Casey Mears buy him. Because he just can't stand him on his rear bumper right now. Makes him way too loose.
Here comes the 11 car on fresher tires than both of these guys.
You know, these 2 tire changes, they make me nervous. I'd rather have 4 tires on them if I was a driver, knowing I got that good grip, because you see the 8 car falling back now because of only those 2 tires. And I'd have to second guess that. I don't know if that's the right decision or not, what they did there, guys.
Well, the 8 car stayed out. Actually, the 11 car took 2 tires on the last caution. But these guys have, like I said, the 11 car just took 2. The 8 car didn't take any on the last caution, so they got a little difference in tire strategy.
So I'd rather have had 2 than none, right?
Yeah.
That's what you're trying to say.
158 laps in. 176 laps to go, and Kyle Busch trying to pick up his second win in 2007. The younger Busch brother has led 4 times for 92 laps. Folks, NASCAR stock car racing coming your way from deep in the heart of Texas, back with more from Texas Motor Speedway in a moment. Thank you very much. Back in Texas, and the 5 car is our leader. This broadcast is available in Spanish by activating your SAP button, presented by ESPN Deportes. Kyle Busch has led 4 times for 99 laps. Folks, we are one lap away from halfway here at Texas Motor Speedway. Been seven caution flags thus far for 28 laps, six different leaders, 11 lead changes. And right now there are 23 cars on the lead lap, and the car that just got back on the lead lap a moment ago was Texas native Bobby Labonte. Let's listen in.
We're good. We're on the lead lap. Fair and square now, bud. Dude, that's right. I forgot. Thought I was racing a freaking 19 car. Woo-hoo. Okay. My bad. Yeah, back in the game. When that switch cut off, your mind was attached to it. Kidding. Well, I've been known to do that, so. All right. Life is good. Life is good. Thank you guys for that. That was awesome. 10-4. It's not your job to think. It's your job to drive. You're doing a hell of a job.
Bobby Labonte, the Corpus Christi, Texas native, is a two-time pole sitter here. His best finished third three different times. He's yet to win here at his home track at Texas Motor Speedway. Pretty pleased to get back on the lead lap, and as he said, be back in the game.
Yeah, that's a, what do you call it, Rusty, feel good?
that's Mr. Feel Good right there. When you think you're out of the game and you're back in it, it's like, oh, man, I forgot about that. Hey, now it puts an extra step in him. Boy, take a look at his A car, Andy. You're watching lap times, pointing it out to me. He's got no tires in this thing, and he's just the fastest car in track that time.
Yeah, he's running them down now. He's got this car working up against that wall. Alan?
Alan? And what he's also got is right there, that white thing on the grill. That doesn't belong there. That would be a little bit of trash on the grill. Junior just called in on the radio just a minute ago, said his car is a little tight in the center of turns 3 and 4. Means the front end is sliding a little bit. Talked about the trash on the grill. Did not talk about any temperature concern at this point. And by the way, he did not get when everybody else did at lap 134. So they're going to need to be in about another 10 laps from now if we don't see a caution between now and then.
Yeah, but with that debris on there, with the track cooling down, Alan, that's probably going to help a lot of things. And it won't hurt the engine, but it'll definitely help the handling as this track cools down.
Oh, I like that downforce. You put a little extra tape on the front of these cars, it makes the front end feel heavier, makes them turn better. But the bad thing is what Alan just said. He's going to come down pit road in 10 laps. That's not good.
Yeah, not good at all. You heard the radio communications a moment ago. And for more information on crew communications, you can log on to ESPN.com. Search word communications. We heard Dale Earnhardt Jr. say the car gets better in long runs, and it obviously has done that. But now his long run's about to end with the pit stop coming up pretty soon. Let's get you up to speed, starting with our leader, Kyle Busch and Dave Burns.
Yeah, Doc, and this car had a long run recently that worked out very well for the five bunch. That was at Lowe's Motor Speedway, where he finished third just three races ago. Same race car, updated just a little bit, and then updated yesterday when he scraped the wall. The crew worked hard to repair that to make it just right, and they got it right. He's led a lot of laps and even had to give up the lead earlier under green flag conditions, Jamie.
And Ryan Newman right behind him. He said his car is pretty good. He's been in the hunt for a win multiple times in these chase races, but has not gotten it done. Five DNFs in the last nine races. As Doc mentioned, it's been 78 races since his last victory. They think they have the car to do it, and Roger Penske agrees that he does. But Ryan said right now his car just doesn't want to rotate, so he's working on fixing that. Right behind him is Denny Hamlin. Now, Denny Hamlin's raced here four times in Texas, finishing in the top 10 all four of those races. He's having himself a pretty good race. He's pretty solid. The car's balanced. He started seventh. He's third right now. Let's go over to Alan Messley.
With Dale Earnhardt Jr., who was leading after not hitting when everybody else did at lap 134. He's fallen back to fourth now. And Andy talked about some of the fastest lap times on the track right now being run by this car. Remember, we heard from Junior earlier as our in-race reporter. This car does not like fresh tires. Takes a while to get going. He's had a long run now, but it's going to need the pit road in a little while, Dave.
And Jeff Burton right now into the top five after being as low as 42nd today. Remember, they had to fix that damage you can see right there on the right rear of the race car. Since then, very good, and good in traffic as well as in clean air. So Jeff Burton, a decent run, a great recovery for this team, Alan.
And Casey Mears is another one of the crowd that did not come onto pit road at lap 134. He restarted third at that point. You can see he's only fallen back to sixth. So a good call there by crew chief Darian Grubb if they don't get snagged by having a pit under green and then having a caution come out. Jamie?
And Martin Truex Jr. started on the pole. He's been in the top 10 all day, seventh right now. He said his car's been snappy loose. He said wrecking loose. At one point, he just came over the radio and, for lack of a better term, he said his car is a piece of junk. So we'll see how that turns out for Martin Truex Jr. Right behind him, Jimmy Johnson. We talked to his crew chief, Chad Knauss, under that last caution. He said they have a great race car. They just need to race. We need to have some green flag runs here and see how has four wins under its belt, including three this year. Right behind him, Kurt Busch. You got to give him a hand, guys. Remember, he had those issues. He had that right, that left rear flat tire, say that four times, early on, and then he had to come in, and they had a problem. They had to change out that spring rubber and change a tire on that right rear. So he's forcing his way back to the front, and he currently is in ninth. Go over to Mike Massaro.
Before his last pit stop, Matt Kenseth radioed in and said his car was very tight and that the right front tire felt like it had 100 pounds of air pressure in it. They made an air pressure adjustment, also a wedge adjustment, and it seems like Matt Kenseth is much happier with the car. Says it's been coming alive, and we've seen it climb up the speed chart throughout the last couple of laps. The guy right behind him, well, he might have the opposite feeling about his race car. He's described it with one word consistently: terrible. And that's Kevin Harvick complaining about being loose in the center, tight off, and very bad in traffic. He's been very frustrated throughout the course of the afternoon with just about every change they made to that race car. Dave?
And Mike, frustrating might describe Clint Bowyer's latest run. He restarted in the 12th position. He hasn't moved from there. On lap 154, he came over the radio and said tight again, unfortunately. And that's what has been biting this 07 car most of the afternoon, Alan.
And Jeff Gordon just came on the radio, told his crew chief, Steve Letarte, that's it. That's as fast as I can go. No grip in the right side tires. Look for them to be on pit road about lap 190 if we don't see a green. Caution, rather. We've got a green now, don't we, there, Doc?
12 car Ryan Newman now coming down pit road to make the stop. Remember, he's one of the cars that stayed out. Let's go down to Jamie Little.
Ryan Newman, you're right, Doc. He did stay out. They wanted to get that track position, but now, of course, the track is green. So they're going to take right sides, move over to the left side for Ryan Newman. Pretty happy with his car. Doc?
So he pitted, and we'll be expecting to see the 8 car as he comes on the pit road here. Budweiser Chevy for Earnhardt Jr., who was turning some of the fastest laps of the afternoon here, quicker than the leaders, but now he is on pit road, headed to you, Alan Bestwick.
And Tony Gibson, the crew chief, calling out to make sure you get the grill. Want to make sure they clean that piece of debris off it. So watch for the front tire carrier. After he comes around there, see him reach for that paper. He grabbed it, pulled it away. Four tire change here. And then comes the part Junior doesn't like with this car set up today. Fresh tires for a little while.
Pretty good pit stop for Tony Gibson and crew. Dale Earnhardt Jr. trying to go back out and get up to speed.
All right, well, we're here to think starts again now. These guys can run about 13 laps longer than Dale Jr. Leaders can. So, Andy, it's going to be a fuel mileage thing again. Who, if the caution flings out, some of these guys are going to get themselves in trouble.
Other car that had not pitted yet is Casey Mears. He's being shown in fourth position. Mears, who stayed out, and here's Ryan Newman. With the brand new, the fresh tires on the racetrack, just goes slipping right on by the 29 car of Kevin Harvick.
And yeah, you'll see just how much these new tires are worth over this 29 car. They'll drive right away from him. This 12 car and the 8 car pitted within a lap of each other. They were running pretty close to each other right before they pitted, so they got fresh tires now and they start making some time.
You know, a lot of drivers like different types of tires. Some drivers like a scuff tire, some of them like a brand new tire. And as Alan Bestwick was telling us, the 8 car, Dale Jr., just doesn't like those new tires. But I would say most of the guys do like them. Most of them like that real quick grip. But some do it different.
Take a look at our Ford lap leaders here. And you'll see that Kyle Busch has led the more laps than he's led all year long. Four times for 116 laps. Jeff Gordon has led 20 laps. Truex, Dale Earnhardt Jr., Juan Pablo Montoya, and Kurt Busch. There have been 11 lead changes among six different leaders. 184 laps in the books at Texas Motor Speedway. You're watching ESPN on ABC.
Welcome back to Texas Motor Speedway. Jimmy Johnson is in his pit box. Four tires, no changes. They're just warning him, hey, it's going to tighten up because that sun is going down. The entire track is almost shaded. He's down and away for that green flag pit stop. Let's go to Mike Massaro.
Matt Kenseth still a little bit tight. They'll go down one half turn on the left rear wedge. Four tire change in fuel for Matt Kenseth. He's away. Let's go to Jamie.
And Martin Truex Jr. in, as I reported just a little bit ago, he said his car is not to his liking. It wasn't as nice as what he said, actually. They're going to take four tires. He scraped the wall just a little bit. They're going to check for damage. He's down and away. Dave?
Kyle Busch gave up the lead earlier under green. It worked out for them. It that cycled around. He's doing the same thing here. This time, car tight, turns one and two, especially four tire change, air pressure adjustment. Mike?
And Kevin Harvick still trying to get that car right. He's described it as terrible all day long. Another air pressure adjustment on that car. Four tire change in fuel on the 29.
Harvey coming down pit road. Tony Stewart still in getting service and getting four tires. He is now down and away. You see him leaving. Jeff Gordon entering pit road, coming down that 45 miles an hour to make what should be his scheduled stop. They still have to make at least two more stops, maybe even three. Let's get under the two pit and Jamie.
And Kurt Busch rallied back from that flat tire. He's in his pit box. Crew chief Pat Tryson said, hey, we have a long way to go. We'll be fine. He's right. They worked his way up. Four tires. And let's go to Allen.
And a big turn on the wedge bolt for Jeff Gordon's crew as they make a four tire change here, trying to help him with that right side grip that he said is lacking on this car. Dave?
Clint Bowyer now hits pit road, 45 mile an hour speed limit, hits his pit box. Four tire change for him. He's been complaining also that that car will not turn. You see the wrench going in the back window. That'll be a wedge adjustment, just a small one for Clint at this point. Guys moving around to the left-hand side now, getting it full of fuel. Remember, these runs have been very long today. Want to make sure every drop's in there, and now he's gone.
0-7, Clint Bowyer going down. You're going to hear a lot of guys, I guess, Andy, talking about these cars not turning as the track's cooling off and those shadows are coming across.
Yeah, you're going to be hearing a whole lot more of that. And you got Ricky Rudd out here leading the race after all these guys chitted.
Yeah, how about Ricky Rudd in his final year of his illustrious 32-year career, the 88 car for Rudd. Rudd making his 904th career start. His best finish fourth here back in the spring of 2002 when he led 29 laps. Kevin Harvick now going by. You heard him talking about how bad Harvick's car has been handling today. Considering how bad the car has been, he has done a heck of a job to keep this car in the top 15.
Yeah, the rest of them, I got fresher tires, but Ricky Rudd's been out for a long time, and Andy, his lap times are awful good. I mean, that last time by, in fact, this time by also. So he's right there in hunt for speed.
He's got a good long-run car, but it seems like these guys get new tires. They can drive away from him pretty good. And he's not had any track position unless they do this pit cycle like we're seeing here.
Lap 194 of 334. And what's going on down here in the pits, guys?
Well, you see him putting, it looks like they're going to add a wheel spacer to the left rear. The only reason I could think maybe they're doing this is because they could have let the left rear wheel loose. And that kind of messes up the threads, dulls the threads in that area, so that maybe they put this spacer on there, put the wheel out on some better threads so the wheel will tighten up.
Yeah, that's happened a lot. If you get a loose wheel, it'll wobble and it'll actually tear the threads up real bad. And Andy, that's a great catch because I never thought of that one. But yeah, that if they bring it out, that'll definitely fix their problem.
Yeah, Ricky Coleman, the rear tire carrier out of Orlando, giving us our crew cam shots of the repairs being made on Greg Biffle's car.
Now the good news is they got it fixed. The bad news is they're three laps down now. Took a while to change that.
Ricky Rudd is the leader at Texas Motor Speedway. Here's the 42 car, who is down a cylinder, running on seven cylinders. AB?
Yeah, I called that in on the radio just a little while ago, Doc, and it's going to be a long struggle for the second half of the race at this high-speed place if you're only operating on seven under the hood.
Juan Pablo Montoya, who took off and led 10 laps early in the afternoon, now just trying to hang on seven cylinders here for the final 138 laps.
Well, the Ganassi team's having a struggle today. They've all had fast cars. The 41 car of Reed Sorensen, the 42 car, and the 40, all are running good. Two of them have crashed. Not one of them's lost a motor, so a tough deal.
137 laps to go, and Ricky Rudd is our leader. Rudd's best finish this year is seventh at Charlotte back in May. Back after these messages and a word from our ABC stations.
ESPN's coverage of NASCAR Nextel Cup Series on ABC. Brought to you by Shell, made to move. And Lowe's, proud home of Jimmy Johnson and T48.
Welcome back to Texas Motor Speedway. It's been labeled big and bad, and with seven cautions, it has been bad. But you could almost say this is a day of truce in the chase for the Nextel Cup, because drivers will truly be mathematically eliminated after today. And all day long, we've been watching that cat and mouse game up front. Jeff Gordon, Jimmy Johnson, and now they have switched positions at the top of the points, Jason.
Yeah, they absolutely have, but they keep each other within eyesight throughout the day. Jeff Gordon's race car is not as perfect as he'd like for it to be, but they continue to manipulate, work on that race car, and try to get it better. Jimmy Johnson's been very solid all day long, so they're both within earshot, and that lead is going to change for the rest of these 135 laps, whatever it is, until we get to the end of the day, and then Jeff Gordon, I think, will come on strong and make a hard run.
Cliff Bowyer sits in 11th. He has probably been one of the most consistent drivers in the chase. What have you thought of his car today?
Well, I think Clint Boyer's done a good job today. He's been like he's always been very consistent all year long, finishing over 96% of the laps run this season. But he just has to get up front. He needs to win this event in order to have a chance to ensconce himself deep enough into the point scenario going into next week. Right now, Jimmy Johnson, Jeff Gordon, they're both staying within the top 12. So that doesn't help Clint Bowyer at all. He has to get up front, lead some laps, and maybe have a chance to win this thing. He's got a charge.
And as always, pit strategy has been huge today. Jamie?
Oh, my gosh. Kurt Busch's problems continue. Just when he works his way back up in the top five, Susie, he had a bad, bad vibration on the right front. They thought it was a tire issue. They didn't want to chance it since they've already had one flat. They brought it in, four tires of fuel, and the two is down and gone.
Boy, Kurt Busch just cannot buy a break here. Having to go back in the pits and come back out now in the two car, now being shown a lap down in 23rd position. Well, time now to reveal the results from our AT&T Crew Chief Challenge. We asked the question of the four drivers who have won here at Texas Motor Speedway in the chase. Who has the best chance to repeat today? Is it Jeff Burton, Carl Edwards, Matt Kenseth, or Tony Stewart? What do you think, guys?
I'm going to go with D, Tony Stewart. I don't know yet.
I'm going to go with A, Jeff Burton.
Okay.
Burton's the only two-time winner here, and it is A, Jeff Burton.
Put it on me there.
There we go. He's won here twice, man.
All right. I didn't think about that part.
Yeah, he's the only driver to repeat. Brett Burton got his very first win here in 1997, and he won his last race here back in the spring of this year. And, of course, driving the AT&T Chevy. Burton coming from the back of the pack now, running awfully well.
Jeff Burton, I apologize for not picking you.
Five car up front, Kyle Busch. This is the most laps that Kyle Busch has led in a race this year. He led 106 laps at Martinsville two races ago. He has now led 129 here at Texas today.
Well, yeah, that 11 car, he's been strong throughout the day. He's got that Dale Earnhardt Jr. line right on top of the track where he's got a lot of momentum. And his lap times, I mean, he is the first three positions are almost identical right now, but he is running these guys down. Got a great car.
Have you ever run that high line like this, Rusty, like these guys are doing?
Man, I never had enough nerve to get that high. You know, I was more of a bottom-of-the-track type guy. Getting up the top of the wall, I don't like it up there. It's faster, looks cooler. No room for error, though.
Denny Hamlin had not led a lap today. And still has not. He tried to make the pass and couldn't quite hang on. Kyle Busch up high, Hamlin down near Denton, Texas, on the inside. But he will make the pass now, as Hamlin now becomes the leader. Jamie.
Well, Denny Hamlin and this team, Doc, they're just trying to redeem themselves after what they went through last weekend with the bad luck having the water in the fuel. Well, Denny was frustrated at his team and thought, man, you guys can't even get the fuel right. What's going on here? If you remember on that restart, he basically shut down and caused that big pileup at the end of the race. But after they went back and looked at it, NASCAR did a great job researching and found out at least 20 teams had water in the fuel. So this week, back to normal, Denny Hamlin running up front. He wants to get a win here before one of these last three races is done, guys, because they know they're not really in contention for that championship. They want to win, and this is a track that he loves. And obviously, as the changing track conditions occur, he's able to run all over the place. Doc?
Yeah, Jamie, that issue in Atlanta cost him two spots in the chase, and as he's back to 10th position, and he becomes the sixth different driver in the chase to lead this race here today. But the guy who's led the most laps, Kyle Busch, let's check in his pits with Dave.
Yeah, Jerry, and he's gone back to second now, reported on the radio that his car will not turn in the center of the corner as A.J. Allmendinger brings out the caution and hits the inside wall, guys.
And, man, that was a big hit. I mean, he come flying down and hit the inside of that wall. He's tore that Red Bull car to smithereens right there.
It's not been A.J. Allmendinger's day at all. It's about the third time he's crashed this car.
You can see it now.
Might be the last.
Yeah, that baby's going to go back to the garage, Jerry, and that could be the end for that day with 122 laps to go. 122
yeah,
laps left
right.
Now.
He's talking.
In the car sliding off the corner, Allmendinger, who qualified fifth, Kevin Harvick just getting by. There's a 31 of Burton getting by, and Allmendinger's car comes right across and just tags that inside concrete wall.
Let's watch Kevin Harvick right here. Oh, right on the top, in the smoke.
Been in front of you, say hi, there you go. Caution, no caution yet.
Just cleared it. Watch, his brakes are locked up. And that was it. But guys, right before that, the brakes were locked up, and he let off the brakes, and that thing took off and run into the wall. And that's one thing you don't want to do. You always want to keep the brakes applied. And generally, the car will spin to the bottom and stop.
There's A.J. Allmendinger, the former Champ Car Rookie of the Year. Had a big year in open wheel racing a year ago with 5 wins, and now running for Rookie of the Year here in NASCAR. Best qualifying effort of his career. He started 5th today, and it you can see the frustration. He really wanted to have a good run here toward the end of his rookie year. Let's check out our All-State Good Hands move of the race. As Kevin Harvick is a driver who made it with an ill-handling race car, he still managed to miss the spinning car of A.J. Allmendinger. On behalf of Kevin Harvick, Allstate will donate $1,000 to the Urban Youth Racing School. But watch him just come through in the smoke.
Take a look on the brakes. He's doing pretty good. He lets off the brake. Oh, don't do that. And when he lets off, it takes back off into the wall. And that's just something he'll learn not to do next time.
Well, pit stops, 121 laps to go, and they're going to come down pit road. Hamlin will lead him down. Kyle Busch, Burton, and Johnson. Let's go down to Dave Burns.
To get Kyle's car back, rear tire changer Josh Kirk will take extra time to take a spring rubber out of the left rear spring. They'll also make a track bar adjustment to save the exit of the corner. Alan?
And top right box, Jeff Gordon's team going to make a track bar adjustment, and also we're going to watch to see if they do something with a spring rubber on that right rear side to try and help this car's turning ability in the center of the corner. Jamie?
And Jimmy Johnson said his car is lazy through the center, but on the exit, he's okay. They took 4 tires. He's down and away.
Race off pit road. Jimmy Johnson nearly getting together with Ryan Newman. How about Kenseth up 4 spots? Jeff Burton back 3. Truex gains a couple. Boyer up 1. And Denny Hamlin came in as a leader and will leave as the leader here at Texas Motor Speedway. Back with a restart in a moment. Welcome back to the Dickies 500, the aerial coverage from high above this beautiful 1,500-acre complex brought to you courtesy of the good folks at Goodyear, the official tire of NASCAR, helping NASCAR drivers get to the finish line for over 50 years. And the man who owns this place, chairman of Speedway Motorsports, Bruton Smith, made an announcement on Friday morning that he had purchased New Hampshire International Speedway for the paltry sum of $340 million from Bob and Gary Bear. He plans to upgrade and improve the facility, and there was a lot of immediate speculation as to maybe some dates changing in 2008. NASCAR Chairman Brian France said the statement that there would be no dates moved in 2008, but possibly down the road they didn't close the door, rule out anything changing. Now, one of the things they would like to be able to do, according to Eddie Gossage, who's the president here, is maybe move this race off of the early weeks of deer hunting season, because, folks, they issued over 1 million deer hunting licenses here in the state of Texas, and so Eddie would like to move this race a couple of weeks early before deer hunting season opens up, and that could be a possibility, moving it earlier in the chase.
Man, if I knew they were going to sell that track that cheap, I might have bought it.
Only $340 million.
Yeah. Boy, Andy, you saved a lot of money.
Ah, folks, Andy Petrie. Pace car pulled away. Our Chevrolet pace car headed down pit road. And here we go. Denny Hamlin and his Chevy going to lead him down. Kenseth behind him in a Ford. Kyle Busch in another Chevy back in 3rd spot.
You could hear that. It sounded like they didn't even back off through that corner on this restart, Rusty. Do they hold them wide open through there on the first lap?
Oh, they got those good tires, Andy. They're not running as fast as they are when they're wound up. They're approaching the corner probably about 150 miles an hour, so they can hold them wide open.
Here's Kenseth. He's holding this thing wide open as he went sailing by the outside of the 11 car in turns 3 and 4, and Matt Kenseth will take the lead.
This is typical Matt Kenseth style. He rides around most of the race, looks at his watch, and finally says, okay, it's time to go.
He's good. He's rich. Oh, spin off at turn 4.
Trouble, the 20 car, 38 above. Harvey gets through.
Off turn 2, a spin was.
See the 25 car of Casey Mears involved.
A little miss right there. I don't know if it was
all the turbulent air going on there, or what?
Jeff Gordon able to get through that. Jimmy Johnson was not around that mess, and that could have been disastrous when it comes to the point standings. There's a 38 of Gilliland. Six car, David Reagan.
Well, this melee happened off of turn two. Everybody stacking up, getting sideways. Take a look at this. Looks like the 25 car Casey Mears bumped in the back of the 88 of Ricky Rudd, shot up the track, got loose and spun. And they all started taking evasive action. Dale Jarrett.
Wow, look at the
29. Ooh, hard impact. He's in it.
29 car Harvick able to get in the back of the 38 and get by. There's Mears involved. Reagan, heavy hard. Heavy hit for David Reagan, the rookie contender. 66 involved as well. Mayfield.
Looks like Casey Mears just came up behind the 88 car and was trying to look for a hole or a way to go, and maybe just got a little bit loose.
There's the contact. Mears and Stewart right in front of 38. Got nowhere to go. Harvick into the back of the 38. Wow, how did Kevin Harvick, he was right behind the 38 and splits Stewart and Gilliland.
Guys, that was incredible with the 29 car. Kevin Harvick just said he was in solid smoke. Let's take a look at this again.
Got one spinning in front of
look
end.
At that.
Go high, go high.
Well, we already gave him the good
come
hands
on,
move.
Mate.
I guess
come
we
on.
Need to give it to him again.
All right, good job. We got the fender, I think.
We'll give him the two hands move on that one. Great effort by Kevin Harvick. Mike.
And the 29 now in, they're taking a good look at all the sheet metal all the way around that race car, seeing if there's any damage. It's hard to tell if there is any right now, but the team taking its time just examining that car, make sure there's nothing wrong with it. Let's go to Alan.
Well, with the number of cars that were on the lead lap and where he was running, Jeff Gordon's team calling him onto pit road here. They had wanted to take a rubber out of the right rear last stop, didn't want to take the time with everybody pitting at once, but where they were, had nothing to lose by giving up a couple of spots here to bring him in, especially with all those cars that were in the spin behind him. The other thing this does is they told the fuel crew to put all the fuel in the car they can. They can go from here to the finish on one more stop, and that could bring that whole economy thing into play a little bit, Mike.
And the work continues on the 29 car, Alan. As you mentioned, they are just taking their time, making sure there's nothing wrong. They were awfully close to the collision there as he rolls down pit road right now. And away, they couldn't find anything too much wrong with that. They didn't really do any repairs on the fenders or on the quarter panels. It looks pretty clean as they made their last stop.
Tony Stewart in getting some patchwork done on the back of his car. He was involved. Again, the 25 of Mears involved, Stewart involved, David Reagan, Kevin Harvick, David Gilliland, and Dale Jarrett. Those are the six cars involved, bringing out caution number 9 here on lap 221. Here's the contact up in the corner. Mears, Stewart, Reagan, Dale Jarrett, and Gilliland involved. Under caution, you're watching ESPN on ABC.
Welcome back to the Dickies 500. We've got a Lone Star State showdown with only 3 races to go in the chase for the Nextel Cup. The story in the FedEx race rundown. And Jeff Gordon came in as the points leader, but he isn't right now. And it's been a day of working really hard on strategy.
Yes, as you know, the initial caution he missed, and they came in afterwards and got 2 tires, but they waited, and everyone else came in and got fresh rubber, and he got behind. So the strategy did pay off because there was a caution eventually that let him get caught up.
Points leaders under pressure. Jimmy Johnson right now with 16-point edge. And just as we expected, it's been a battle between those two teammates.
Jimmy Johnson's had a really good race car all day long. They maximized their pit position strategies. They got in and out of the pits very efficiently. Jeff Gordon struggled a little bit, but I'm looking for that 24 car to come on with about 50 to go.
Inches and great driving can make the difference as Jeff Gordon just narrowly escaped a nasty wreck that brought out the 9th car.
Well, I'll tell you what, Jeff Gordon. Just out, he held his breath a lot longer than everyone else and drove through that and got lucky. You got to be lucky to win a championship sometimes.
Day of truth, Doc. Drivers 391 points or more behind the leader will be mathematically eliminated following this race. Right now, 6 drivers are out.
Exactly, Susie. 6 would be out, and it would be 6 left in it to battle for the final 2 events. And how close was that for Jeff Gordon? He was right there and had just made the pass when that caution, when all the contact occurred. Remember, he and Jimmy Johnson have not had the best luck in this track, and he's never won at Texas Motor Speedway. Matt Kenseth leads him down. Kenseth driving the same car. He won with it California early in the year. Could he pick up win number two in 2007? Green flag waves. 110 laps to go. It's Kenseth, Hamlin, Kyle Busch, Jimmy Johnson, and Ryan Newman.
Man, look at that 17 go through that corner.
And Andy, just like you said on these restarts, they're approaching the corners about 150 miles per hour on a restart. Once they get wound up, they're approaching about 190 miles an hour. So at 150, they can make this corner wide open.
Looks like Matt Kenseth hasn't backed off yet.
No, he hasn't. He looks great out there. No, Kenseth's been hanging out in the back, working on his car, and this is his style of racetrack. These mile-and-a-half tracks have been so good for him his whole entire career, and Texas is no different.
17 car pulling away now by 8 tenths of a second over the 11 car of Denny Hamlin. Let's listen into some radio communication on the 17 car of Matt Kenseth.
Did you like my restart?
That was pretty awesome. I liked this.
I don't know if I could make it through their flat, but it made it
pretty good.
I think he scared the 11. He was expecting this. Well, I couldn't tell whether he was going to give it to me or not. He was down, then he came up, and he went down and started lifting. Gave it to me there, so it was good.
But he's talking about going through their flat, is going flat on the mat with a throttle and not backing off. And his car's sticking really good on his restart. Now he's got that clean air. He's just, man, his car looks great right here.
Update on David Ragan, the impressive rookie candidate, had been treated and released from the infield care center after that hard impact. In fact, our Mike Massaro is standing with him.
That's right, Doc. Just walked out of the care center. Are you okay?
Oh, yeah, certainly. Just disappointed. Jimmy Finnegan and all the AAA team did an awesome job preparing a great Ford Fusion for me today. I think we had a top 15, top 10 car. I don't know. Everyone was checking up in front of me. I checked up as soon as I could, and before I know it, I was turned around wrecking.
And Dave, he said he had a hard time really determining what happened, but you can see he's out of the race. Dave?
Same kind of thing over here, Mike. What did happen? And Casey Mears staying in the car right now. His crew going to work on it. They'll repair this 25 car to get it back on track and maybe pick up a couple of positions, not just for the rest of this year, but remember, this transfers over to Junior for the 88 car for next year, the points to the 25 car. Also back here, Mark Martin's car was involved. He's out of the car right now. They're trying to repair it to return to the track.
Great point, Dave. Casey Mears in 14th in the points standings, just 79 points behind Dale Earnhardt Jr. in 13th, trying to get in that 13th spot. And remember, those points will indeed benefit Dale Earnhardt Jr. in that 88 car at Hendrick next year. How about the 48 car of Jimmy Johnson? He's starting to hustle this car, going to the whip here in the final 100 laps.
Well, the sun's setting right now. This whole entire track is about to get dark, and that's where this team is always the best at. Look at those dark, those night races, Andy, at Charlotte Motor Speedway, Lowe's Motor Speedway. For that 600, the track changes, and these guys can always keep up with it.
This is that last phase I was talking about, because the entire racetrack now is shaded. There's no sun on it, and the temperature drops quite a bit, but it'll stabilize from here, and it might get a little cooler as we go, but it's made that last transition.
And these guys have been chasing these setups throughout the day. It's like you said earlier, staying ahead of it, making a change that the driver doesn't want at that moment, knowing that a little later it's going to get better. He's just got to deal with that through that transition, though.
Ticker at the top of your screen shows you where the drivers are running in the race. Right below it, the chase ticker shows you Jimmy Johnson now has a 16-point lead over Jeff Gordon. Clint Bowyer back in third. By the way, the 5 car of Kyle Busch right now would gain 2 spots in the chase all the way up to 4th position. There is Kyle Busch. He is running 3rd on the racetrack. He is 4th in the chase, and the man chasing him on the track is the chase leader.
That car looks good. It's been looking good all day long. They've caught up with it. Man, there's a heck of a race out there between Bobby Labonte and Kurt Busch. It looks like Busch just now got around him. Busch wants to get himself in a position for the lucky dog to get it back, and he just got it back. Just as soon as he passed Bobby Labonte, the caution flies.
Greg Biffle comes across the grass in the 16 car.
Don't speed up now.
And that was a great call, Rusty, because that was a critical pass to be able to be the lucky dog and get back on to get the free pass as Biffle brings out caution for the 10th time today.
Did you know that caution was coming out, Rusty?
No, I was glancing out the window. I'm looking at the monitor and the window, and I saw that 2 just flying on the bumper at 43. I said, what's up? And I go, oh, that's what's up. He's racing for the lucky dog. And, boy, is he a lucky dog right now, that's for sure.
He gets the free pass. There's Biffle, who's none the worse for wear. Show you again what happened to Biffle here coming out of four.
Well, looks like another case just getting so high on top of the racetrack, getting in that dirty part of the track, and he just got loose and spun that thing.
How did Jeremy Mayfield miss him in the 66 car, right almost in the door?
You know, sometimes when it's your day, Jerry, because when all that smoke's in front of you, you can't see. You just got to remember where you were before the smoke happened and not move the wheel much and hold a steady ground, and that's what Jeremy did. Did a good job getting through there.
For more information on track incidents, you can log on to ESPN.com. Search word safety. They're poised on the pit wall. This is not yet the money stop, but it's getting darn close, Andy.
One thing they need to do right here is if they're going to change their car, they need to anticipate what they need for this last run because they don't want to make these changes on the last pit stop.
Got to be proactive. You want to be able to make everything you're going to need to have now because that last pit stop needs to be efficient and extremely fast. Here comes Kenseth, Hamlin, Kyle Busch, Jimmy Johnson, and Truex. Leading them all on the pit road, Mike Massaro.
And Matt Kenseth and Robbie Reiser not willing to give up too much track position. The call is for a two-tire change. They'll also make a wedge adjustment, trying to flee him up in the center just a little bit. Dave?
No chassis changes for Kyle Busch, but two tires. He stalls it, trying to leave pit road. This will slow him down. Now he gets it fired. He is out of here. Allen.
And it'll be a right side tire only change for the 24 of Jeff Gordon. Plus, they stopped to pull a rubber from that right rear, Jamie.
Jimmy Johnson, right side only, just like last week. That won him the race. He wanted his car to feel a little more free. Air pressure adjustment, that's it for 48 of Jimmy Johnson.
And two tires only for Denny Hamlin, and he will pick up a spot. Kenseth back one. Elliott Sadler, good pit stop for the Gillette Evernham guys. Up five positions. Truex back four. Jeff Burton in 10. Back after these messages and a word from our ABC stations. Back at Texas Motor Speedway, NASCAR Nextel Cup Series action here in Fort Worth, Texas. Under caution for the 10th time today, Greg Biffle spinning out of turn four through the grass, brought out the yellow flag. Everyone on and off pit road. A break for the two car of Kurt Busch, who not only got back on the lead lap and got the free pass, he had some damage on the hood of the car.
He had a big hole in front of that. He's knocking it down flat.
I wonder why they didn't get a big hammer to hit it there.
Yeah, right. This bare bond material they're putting on the front of the car is very adhesive. It sticks real good. Holds up at these high speeds of 200 miles per hour. And they want to fix this thing because they got 100 laps to go yet. Well, now it's 98 laps to go. They got enough time to get back in the game here.
All that of towers in the wind tunnel, and you adjust the hood with a 20-pound sledgehammer. Here's what they were trying to fix there. And I wonder what he hit.
He must have got up underneath somebody when they were checking up for one of these wrecks and it peeled that hood back. That's really a big hole. They needed to fix that, and it looks like they've done a good job of repair.
Well, he is back on the lead lap. The hood is repaired with that sledgehammer, and now we'll see what he can do with it in the final 98 lap. Should be one more pit stop. Pace car leading him down, Denny Hamlin in the 11 car. Right now has gained three spots in the chase, all the way up to seventh in the chase points. Can he pick up the win here in Texas? Green flag.
See if Matt Kenseth can get that restart he got on Denny Hamlin a couple of restarts ago where he just kind of blew right by him here in one and two.
Well, Hamlin really sticking at the bottom of that racetrack now off of turn two. And this is where Kenseth got the run down the backstretch on the previous restart.
And guys, I expect to see some different characters up front right now because this track has definitely made the 100% change right now. We see different cars. See Denny Hamlin leading. Matt Kenseth up there running good right now. Ryan Newman.
18 car, J.J. Yaley. That's the green car there, the third one in the picture. He is a lap down in 17th position. He would get the free pass if the caution were to come back out. Among the leaders, it is Hamlin, Kenseth, Jimmy Johnson. There's Jimmy Johnson in third, Ryan Newman fourth, Kyle Busch fifth, Bowyer sixth, and Jeff Gordon in seventh spot.
And boy, Jimmy Johnson is cycling himself up to the front of this pack when it's money time. Running third right now with some real fast lap speed, so he's got a good car.
Jeff Gordon there hovering back behind some traffic behind Bobby Labonte in the 43 and the 07. In fact, he's battling Bowyer for sixth position. Alan?
Well, Doc, we followed this team's efforts to improve their car all throughout this race so far. We've talked about changing track conditions and the fact that we're closing in on the end of the race. All that wrapped up in this radio transmission between crew chief Steve Letarte and the driver, Jeff Gordon.
We're definitely more comfortable in the back. I mean, I could use more, but we've got, now we can free it up.
got the other rubber out. I adjusted some right rear air. We got a little wedge out of it. Might be a little snug on rights only, but we're just, you know, I don't think it's going to be as bad as having to pass three more guys, so.
Well, we haven't passed anybody all day, so this is about the only way we can do it.
Yeah, well, they did pass four guys. They came into the pits 11th on that stop. They came out 7th. That's where they run now. This team setting themselves up for that final pit stop that, depending on where a caution comes, everybody can make the race on one more stop once we get inside of 60 laps to go.
Boy, Andy, you talk about a big change in the temperatures out there in the racetrack. I mean, things have changed big time since this race has started. Take a look at it.
Yeah, 24 degrees of track temperature can make a big, big difference in the way that car handles.
Not a lot of the outside air temperature, only 4 degrees, but look at the track temperature. Started at 95 all the way down to 71. That is a huge feel for a driver on the racetrack. The car handles definitely different. That sun's not beating on it right now. That black asphalt's not getting hot.
And that's where all the heat in the racetrack comes, is that radiant heat from the sunshine. Once that thing gets shaded, which now the whole track is shaded, that won't change anymore the rest of the race. We'll get a little cooler air temp, but that shade has already stabilized the track temp.
Guys, I want to report one thing. The 99 car, Carl Edwards, early in the race, had a problem with the right front chain, and that's hooked to the anti-roll bar. And what happens, that chain moves up and down to let the car comply through the corners better. That chain got bound up. It got locked up in the wrong way. And because of that, the car was handling terrible. They have fixed it, and that car is out there running some fast speeds right now. Top 5 speeds. And Mike, that had a really kill this car early.
And yeah, it did for sure, Rusty. You know, he was complaining about the car being extremely tight. They couldn't figure out what it was. And when they finally did diagnose that it was the kink in the chain, it took them 4 consecutive pit stops before they finally were able to correct it. Once they did correct it, the car came back to life. For a further explanation, let's go to Tim Brewer in our Dish Tech Center.
Thanks, Mike. What the fans normally need to know about this is on a turnbuckle. That's the way the sway bar is hooked up. To get through the bumps, we actually use a chain. But when that chain got twisted, they got the bar in a terrible bind. Therefore, the chassis wouldn't work properly. But when they unloaded the chain, that's when the car took off again. Jerry?
And that's a great explanation, Tim, on what happened there with this crew trying to get Carl Edwards. And boy, what a difference that just a tiny little adjustment makes. And here's what they were doing earlier in the day. Watch the crew now trying to work and trying to make that to unload that.
Okay, they got the thing so bound up, it's almost impossible to get it unbound, so they're going to cut. They take this Sawzall, this electric saw, they're going to saw the link in two and then replace it, put another one on there.
And it's hard to believe they're having to do that, Andy. It must be so bound up they just can't physically get it pop loose, because it was definitely on the car correctly at one time. And by jacking it up and getting it all bound up, taking tires on and off, something's went disarray there. And I remember a lot of the young race teams have had this happen in the past, and you can't ever let this happen.
Look at Carl right here. Looks like he's got some clear glasses or goggles on underneath this smoke lens cover for his helmet. So he was anticipating the sun going down and getting dark. And then he flips that visor up, and he's got that eye protection to keep that sand and grit out of his eye.
That is pretty cool. You know, he does a lot of mountain biking, and it looks like some type of glasses he wears doing that, something he's comfortable with. But, hey, that's pretty smart. Lift the visor up, put the clear ones on.
07, Clint Bowyer on pit road. Just cannot be scheduled, I wouldn't think. Dave?
He's worried about the right rear tire, Doc. He thinks it has a loose wheel. Spotter Mike Dillon told him, this is your call. You need to make the call. Much as Greg Biffle did yesterday during the Busch Series race. Now, Biffle didn't end up having a problem, but when your guys are going around here to over 190 miles an hour, you give the driver that option to bring his car in.
And he just went a lap down, but he could not ignore it. Remember what happened to Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the late laps at Atlanta last week? He had a vibration, and he ignored it, and what happened? The tire came off. But he said, I blame myself for ignoring that. Clint Bowyer says, I'm in a championship hunt. I cannot ignore it. For more information, by the way, on anti-sway bars, you can log on to ESPN.com, search word Tech Center.
Oh, man, we talked, Brad Doherty talked at the beginning of the show, and so we can't have any mistakes. This needed to be the no-mistake 500, and now we've got a loose wheel or something went disarray in the 07 car, Clint Bowyer, one of our chase contenders.
Denny Hamlin has not won a race in the chase thus far. His best finish was 4th at Talladega. Could he pull it off today? 85 laps to go. You're watching ESPN on ABC. Welcome back to the Dickies 500. Beautiful sunset here in West Texas. Glad to have you with us here, Texas Motor Speedway. Beautiful aerial shots, courtesy of our good friends at Goodyear, the official tire of NASCAR, helping NASCAR drivers get to the finish line for over 50 years. Crowd of 190,000 plus on hand here, race number 8 in the chase. Jeff Gordon, Jimmy Johnson, neither one had ever won at Texas Motor Speedway. And here are the guys that have stumbled this year. Here are the worst finishes of the 12 drivers in the chase. You see Clint Bowyer's worst finish is 12th. But, folks, he came on the pit road because he had a tire issue. And guess what? They changed right side tires, Andy, and he had to come back in.
I saw that car come in, and they said they were going to change right sides because he had a vibration. And that almost never works out to just change two tires because, for one thing, you don't let the driver make that decision. You know, with all due respect, Rusty, the driver can't tell whether that thing's loose, which side it is. They just know they got a vibration. They
and
can't
I
tell.
I totally agree with you, Andy. When that car gets loose, you think it's a right rear to vibrating, but you know the rear axle's hooked together, so you can't tell if it's a right rear or left rear. They left it up to Clint to make the decision. He said, right sides. And son of a gun if it wasn't the left.
Dave?
Well, there's some more information here, guys, and that's why it looks a little confusing down here in the 07 pit. When they pitted on the lap 217, actually that was a 217 restart, lap 212, for A.J. Allmendinger's crash, they took on four tires. The last time they hit pit road, two right side tires. So that's why the driver and crew chief both assume the only thing they'd have to be worrying about would be the right side.
Well, I guess, Dave, there is a little logic in that, but last week we saw Dale Earnhardt Jr. lose the left rear tire after just changing right side tires on his last pit stop. Same thing, but sometimes it takes, you know, 40, 50 laps for the thing to get plenty loose. But, you know, still just every time that happens, I change four tires. That's just my rule, and I don't let the driver make that decision.
And, you know, Andy, you're exactly right. I mean, this is said, it's always bites you more than it helps you. I mean, very seldom do you see a driver or a crew chief make the right call under those circumstances. Just one of those things. Your gut tells you it's the right side, and your brain tells you to put on four, and then you go, hey, we're wrong. All of us are wrong.
Well, lights are coming on here at Texas Motor Speedway, but the lights may have just dimmed a little bit in the championship chase for the 07. Here's the 11 car of Hamlin going by. By the way, you won Pablo Montoya fans. We noted earlier that he is down a cylinder running in the 42 car, down on seven cylinders. That's why he was so easily passed a moment ago. Hamlin the leader. Kenseth running in second spot. And Jimmy Johnson back in third. More on Denny Hamlin. Let's check in with Jamie Little.
Well, Doc, I tell you what, this race is going to come down to who was prepared for these dark conditions. Rusty was touching on it with Carl Edwards. He was prepared. But in talking to some teams, they didn't know what to expect because of daylight savings. Well, one team that was prepared, Denny Hamlin's crew. I talked to Mike Ford, his crew chief, earlier today, and he told me we are going to end this race under the lights. He said we're going to build in enough adjustability that as that track cools down and tightens up, we will be able to be in the top five at the end. And if we're in the top five, we can win this thing. Right now, guys, it's getting cooler. Denny Hamlin is dominating. Mike?
You talk about a team that is really hungry for a win. That is certainly the 17 team of Matt Kenseth. I spoke with Robbie Reiser this morning, and he said they've worked harder this year than they've worked in any of the last 4 years, and they've got the least to show for it. Only one victory so far. And he said the way the chase has gone, completely opposite of the way the season began. He said at the beginning of the season, they were taking underperforming race cars to the track and squeezing a top 10 finish out of it. Here, it's been just the opposite in the chase. They've had top 10 cars, but no results to show for it. They're trying to change that this afternoon, running very strong in second, looking for just their second win of the season.
Remember, this 17 car back in the spring was passed on the white flag lap. Matt Kenseth had led 16 consecutive laps and then was passed by Jeff Burton on the white flag lap to take the win away. So obviously he is hungry. And by the way, you talk about coming back. This team, 17 team, back-to-back top five finishes in the chase. Fifth at Martinsville, fourth at Atlanta last week. This team getting stronger as the chase progresses.
I mentioned something last week about this, but Matt, you know, Matt Kenseth started this chase on a little different strategy than he normally goes. He's going for the lead right here, but he's been doing this, you know, where he sits back, waits for this time of the race to take this thing to the front. Now he's doing what he does the best. He's doing it right here late in the race instead of trying to charge early. That's not been his style.
Boy, take a look at this duel they got going right now, though, Andy. I mean, you see the 11 car, Denningham on the bottom. He's got the momentum on the top of the track. And Matt's he's tired of following. He's trying to get it done on the bottom. He's trying to see if he can clear him as he exits the corner. And is it going to happen? No. They're side by side again now in the back straightaway. Matt says, enough of this. I'm tucking back in.
Or maybe not.
And maybe not. Now he's got a lap car to deal with, which is going to help Denny get that momentum and keep it. Keep the lead.
That's Johnny Sauter down there in the 70 car. He had the 7 car to deal with a moment ago, and Robbie Gordon, as he was making the pass, and had to back out just slightly to give Robbie Gordon some room on the bottom of the track.
And guys, take a look at the right side of your screen. You see Jimmy Johnson starting to creep in this picture right now. He's in third, and he's getting closer and closer to him coming down this back straightaway. His lap times are excellent. He's running down the top two right now.
Remember, there will be one more scheduled pit stop, Andy Petrie, your crew chief, as you start thinking about that. And you were talking about as you watch the battle of Hamlin go back by. Now, you're formulating strategy for what's going to happen on this final stop. And you want to, do you gamble now? Do you try to make it a quick stop here? Or do you make it an ordinarily four-tire stop?
Well, you just wait and see. Depends on which position you're talking about, Doc. If you're one of these leaders, you look at how big of a lead you have, how good your car is, and then whether you can afford to gamble. If you've got a big lead and your car's really good on four tires and you think you got enough time to get it back, you get four. But some of these guys are going to gamble and maybe take two tires or do something for track position. Boy, these guys are going at it.
Well, they are. We've seen drivers take two tires more than I ever expected they would take today, Andy. I mean, generally, four tires are your friend. The two tires are tending to get the job done pretty good here today, and nobody really expected that.
Remember what happened at Atlanta a week ago? It was a gutsy call on the final pit stop. We talked about the guys that have to make the difficult calls on pit road. How about these guys? Two separate lines, about 30 feet apart on the racetrack, and they come right almost together coming up off the corner.
And, Jerry, that's the coolest feel when you get a lot of momentum and you pass a guy on the outside. But while this has happened, take a look at Jeff Gordon. He's catching Clint Bowyer. And, boy, Clint's in trouble because he's off the pace. He's a lap down. He's two laps down, Bowyer is right now.
Yeah, but look at Jeff Gordon is now 12th. He's falling back in the field. And so Jimmy Johnson is now third. He's gaining some points big time.
And remember, a year ago, Jimmy Johnson took the point lead after this race in Texas and never looked back. Laps are winding down. Back in a moment. Back at Texas Motor Speedway, folks, things have just changed in a hurry here. Caution for the 11th time, and it was the battle up front that we were watching every single lap. Kenseth and Hamlin on the bottom of the racetrack and top of the racetrack coming off. Now watch the dicing here between the 17 and 11.
And they were passing back and forth, Andy.
Big crossover move right here with Denny Hamlin underneath the 17. And this kind of swapped spots on these guys. And then they were just duking it out lap after lap.
And now Denny Hamlin's on the bottom of the track. Kenseth gets it outside. Boom. He gets him in a left rear quarter panel. Knocks him sideways. He takes himself out. Big damage on the right side of Denny Hamlin. And he looks like he's going to be out of the race for a while right now.
Just tight, tight racing.
And these two are going at it.
Mike Massaro.
And as a result of that contact, Doc, a left rear tire went down on the 17 car. They'll make that change there. They'll also make a track bar and wedge adjustment along with four tires and fuel. Dave?
Not a good run that time for Kyle Busch. Tight to the center, little free off track bar adjustment, four tires. Alan?
Jeff Gordon says this car won't turn in a 40-acre field. Both wrenches spinning, track bar, wedge, four tires, air pressure. Lots of changes, Jamie.
Jimmy Johnson said his car got real loose after that last two-tire stop. They took four tires this time. Jimmy Johnson down and away, 14.3. Doc?
Jimmy Johnson, was that the money stop? It was, if you're counting where he is. There's Jimmy Johnson gains a spot as our leader. Kyle Busch up. Kenseth down two. Remember, they had the flat tire. Kurt Busch, Truex, you see the race off of pit road.
5 points. You guys got it.
Watch Chad Knaus' reaction here as they're exiting the pits. Yeah, we got there. Rick Hendrick behind him. And Jimmy Johnson wins the race off of pit road. Back after these messages and a word from our ABC station.
This Motor Speedway, and we are in for another dramatic finish. Denny Hamlin, twice in a row. Last week, was it the water in the fuel line? Remember, he stalled out in Atlanta. Now he crashed and almost took Matt Kenseth with him. But we are set now for one of the great finishes, and guess who's on top? Guess who can achieve a stranglehold? Jimmy Johnson, going for still another win, is in first, and Jeff Gordon, Doc, has to get the pedal to the metal to try to stick with him right here, because Jimmy right now is in danger of opening up an insurmountable lead.
Exactly, Brent. It was here a year ago that Jimmy Johnson took the points lead and never looked back. Johnson the leader. Jeff Gordon has come back on the pit road a moment ago to top off with fuel, as did the 8 car of Dale Earnhardt Jr. 58 laps to go. Now we're going to see what they got. It's time to turn up the wick, as they say in racing circles. Fresh tires, the 07, by the way, running with Jimmy Johnson, and they're rubbing down the bottom of the racetrack.
Oh, man, he's trying to get one of those laps like Clint Bowyer is. He knows he's got to get it done now. And he gets by, and you take a look at Kyle Busch on the outside. He wants to lead this race.
Jimmy Johnson can ill afford to rub with the 07 car, so Kyle Busch sails by and takes the lead, and he will keep the 07 car now 2 laps down.
The reason he's racing so hard for this spot is because he wants to get a lap back so he can be in position to get the lucky dog. Right now, he's 2 laps down.
And he's just got to stay driving hard right now, but Kyle Busch has got the clean air. And guys, that car's been like bullet fast all day long, so I don't expect Bowyer to catch him.
The reason for the caution a moment ago was the contact between the 17 of Kenseth and the 11 of Denny Hamlin. Let's listen in to Matt Kenseth radio.
Hey, do you want to give the 11 a message for me or not really? I'm already headed that way. You think you want me to add to it? Yeah, I would actually. I always give him a lot of room, and half the time he does it to me. I know we're racing for the lead, he wants all the points, but we're not going to get any points all wrecked. And I had a couple times I could have stayed in it and put him in a bad spot, and I didn't do it. I gave him plenty of room, and needs to give a little bit of that back, or they're both going to be wrecked. There's just not really a reason to do that. Pretty stupid to do it that early in the race there. I was patient, took my time to them, getting to them and trying to pass them, gave them all kinds of room.
Well, I can tell you one thing. He might tell Denny Hamlin that. It's not going to make Denny Hamlin feel any better right now. That's probably going to irritate him.
I could definitely see where Matt Kenseth is coming from, because he did race that 11 car very clean. He did have a couple of opportunities to squeeze the 11 car and didn't. He gave it to him, and so I think he was just expecting the 11 car to return the favor.
A lot of frustration right there between those two. That's obvious. Jamie?
Well, guys, I asked Jack and Ass. I heard you talking to who can make it, who won't, you know, for the rest of the race on fuel. So I asked Jack and Ass, who's usually not very emotional, and he was emotional on that last stop. I looked up. I said, are you guys going to make it? And he had a big smile. You know, so I think he's banking on hopefully one more caution before this thing's over.
48 car did not come back in. The 24 car did come in and top off, and there comes Jamie McMurray, by the way. Good run for McMurray, coming by and taking the position away from Jeff Gordon. Gordon trying to get back by, and that is for the 10th spot. More on Jeff Gordon. Let's check in with Alan Bester.
Yeah, and their fuel situation, Doc, even though they did stop and top off, Steve Letard told Jeff Gordon they were close on fuel. Close doesn't mean they're good, and you always have to take into consideration the possibility of a green-white checker finish. They restarted 12th. They're running 11th right now, and Jimmy Johnson's running second, and fuel is close. Boy, I think there's a few fingernails going to get sheared off down here.
I guarantee you there is, Alan. There's a lot of these guys that cannot make this run. I think the 24 car maybe has one of the best shots of doing that. But if he's, Steve Letarte's going to have to tell Jeff Gordon to save a little bit of fuel.
Not like either one of these guys have had a lot of luck at this racetrack either. Laps are winding down. Can they hang on fuel? Kyle Busch is the leader. Back at Texas Motor Speedway, folks, stay tuned after NASCAR coverage for an all-new Sunday on ABC, starting with America's Funniest Home Videos, followed by Extreme Makeover Home Edition, then the wildest Halloween party you've ever seen on Desperate Housewives, followed by a new Brothers and Sisters. It all starts right after NASCAR coverage at normal times in the Mountain and Pacific time zones right here on ABC. Well, that cranks up in about 45 laps, folks. 45 laps to go here at Texas Motor Speedway. Lights are on and laps are ticking down. How balanced does a car have to be to run this well here at a mile-and-a-half racetrack? Well, let's show you what happens here in terms of balance, downforce, and clean air on the 5 car.
Guys, our draft trackers really showed a lot of aerodynamic changes this year and helped educate the viewers, but this right here is showing us total downforce on the front and total downforce on the back. And when this car gets around different cars and you pull up behind, you'll see the green on the front go completely away. And if there's a car gets up behind this car, you'll see the green on the back go completely away. So later on, we'll try to find one of those instances and show you. But it really does affect the way the car's handled out here to track this fast. Andy, speeds of over 200 miles an hour going at the corner. Aerodynamics is huge, man.
Yeah, and you want that car to be balanced, too. And that's what that's showing you right there, was there was an equal distribution of downforce. And when these guys get together and get cars in front and behind, it changes that. And that's why this clean air is so important.
Got to have downforce, but you need to have something else today and tonight. I think it's called fuel, right, Jamie?
That's right. Doc and Jack now decided he didn't want to wait 30 laps to find out if they're going to be short or not or what their situation is. So he just radioed in after he talked to his little math wizards down here in the pit box, and this is what he told his driver, Jimmy Johnson.
All right, but I need to start backing off just a little bit, saving me some fuel. I need to save me about 3 laps total.
And Chad Knauss waiting for a caution flag, desperately telling his driver, who just avoided somebody on the track, guys. I believe that's the 78, just avoided him. So keeping his eyes open and hopefully going to conserve enough fuel to make it to the end.
Jamie, still no caution flag. A caution would be a huge help to Jimmy Johnson. This is Joe Nemechek, by the way, who they announced this week has just signed a 3-year contract with this team, Furniture Row Racing. Hoping to go to a 2-car team in 2008. He scrapes the wall, but is able to make it down on the inside 2-pit road. And we will stay green here with 41 laps to go.
And you must wonder if there's debris off of turn 2 because of this scraped wall. I mean, when you hit them, I mean, usually something flies off the car. A lot of body filler, Bondo, things like that, Andy, that his team has used to paint these cars and under the paint job. And so that could have happened. So we have to take a look at this.
Yeah, you see this right here. This graphic is showing how Jimmy's floating the car down in the corner. That's what I'd be telling my driver. Let's save a little fuel, back off a little bit early. Don't hit the brakes quite as hard. Those brakes just use up fuel. And, you know, that might get them those 3 laps they're looking for.
You know, right before we were looking at another picture, I was looking at the tailpipes on the 48 car of Jimmy Johnson. You saw the flames coming out of the car as he was getting out of the throttle. I'll try to show you that shortly here. But it really shows how early he's getting out of the throttle. He's coasting for a long time. Out of the throttle, out of the throttle. Then he picks the throttle up very, very easy. Nothing abruptly. And that really saves a lot of fuel. Now, he's got to save 3 laps, so he's got to keep doing this.
While you watch this,
see the flames coming out of the right rear there. And he's out. Now back into it, Jerry.
Fuel is critical for Jimmy Johnson. And by the way, the 11 car, another one of the chase contenders, Denny Hamlin, has gone to the garage area. He's made the hard left-hand turn. He was a leader. And despite a lot of damage on the front of this 2 car, Kurt Busch is setting sail. He is coming in a hurry.
Well, they fixed it. You know, they got that hood beat back down and got this all sealed back up. Buddy, he's driving the wheels off this thing. He's coming up. He's running the fastest laps on the racetrack right now.
So Kyle Busch, the leader. Jimmy Johnson in second. Kenseth, then this car you just saw, Kurt Busch a moment ago. Truex, Newman, Jeff Burton, Kevin Harvick, Tony Stewart. And there is Jeff Gordon back in 10th position, as he has gone by Tony Stewart to take the 9th spot away. Back up front, Kyle Busch is our leader, and more on fuel with Dave.
He is laying down the lap stock, but maybe at just a slightly slower pace. He was asked to save fuel by his crew chief, Alan Gustafson. He, of course, asked, can we make it to the end? And Gustafson said 3:34, but this is going to change everything. Biffle crashing.
Greg Biffle brings out caution.
Yeah, but
great report, Dave. It just all changed right here.
It's on fire.
Well, they got a big fire underneath the 16 car, Greg Biffle, right now. See how big that thing gets. You might have to get out of that car before it gets it back to pit road.
Okay, guys, we got 36 laps to go, and Jeff Gordon sitting back there in 9th spot. If he wants to get a good finish, he might need to try to roll the dice right here and maybe take 2 tires.
What would you do?
I would take 2 in this spot and just see what he can do.
Here's a 16 car Biffle bringing out caution for the 12th time.
All right, Chase, you just get out.
I think you see the inside just full of smoke, and he's got to get out in a hurry.
He's got an oil cooler ruptured or an oil line, and if he keeps driving, the thing keeps pumping it out on the header.
Yeah, but he's breathing that stuff right now, guys. He's got to get out of there to get some fresh air to himself, or else he's going to, you know, it could hurt him bad.
Yeah, smoke inhalation. They're trying to help him get out, get unhooked.
And they're saying get the side window out, knock it out so some of this air. This is the window on the right-hand side that he's trying to get out, and that would really help ventilate some of this air out of this car. So Greg's out. Good news.
Show you the contact here that brought out the caution for Greg Biffle here on lap 298.
Same deal as before here. He just gets a little bit sideways, loses the thing.
Yeah, this is the second time this car, just like you said, gets out from underneath them right there. And it just, he's trying to run so high, and the car just doesn't have the grip.
Brian Vickers coming by. That was the contact on the hood. And there's the fire that erupts. You're talking about the oil cooler, the fire that erupts in the front of the car and underneath where the driver is sitting.
And as long as that engine's spinning over, this is pumping oil out on the headers, and it just makes an intense fire, as you see here. Finally just told him to stop the car. Maybe the fire will go out and he can just jump out of it.
And Andy, you need the spotter to help you because you have no vision. You can't see out of the front of that car. And that's a good job, the spotter, to get out of the car, get out of the car, stop it. Just stop it there. I mean,
because the driver can't see that flame.
Cannot see that flame. And I had a big blow up in Michigan one year, big fire. And I had to rely on the spotter to tell me where to stop and where to turn the car to get out.
And that's why the pits are closed, because it's right there where you would come onto pit road there, and it has it blocked, so they currently have the pits closed for all the drivers. Let's check in on our ESPN Dish Tech Center and Tim Brewer.
Thanks, Jerry. The oil cooler's located over here on the left side. Anytime it's pretty much punctured, or any of these oil lines right here, like Andy says, when the engine's turning over, it's constantly pumping oil out. When it gets up under the car, gets on the tailpipes beneath the car, and that's where the fire's created. That's what you've seen coming out of the back of the car. Jerry?
Thank you, Tim. Great explanation of where all that oil is coming from. And it blazes up in a hurry. And they were there trying to help get Greg Biffle out. Finally, you saw him. Just, you saw the technician just cut the radio wire to be able to get him away from the car.
And, Andy, those oil coolers, they can be mounted anywhere in the car, can't they?
Oh, yeah. There's anywhere in front of the engine. The rule says it has to be forward of the engine. A lot of guys run them right behind the radiator. You see them in different spots. But no matter where it is, if it gets severed and it gets cracked, that oil just goes everywhere.
For you Denny Hamlin fans, by the way, he had gone to the garage area. Now that car has come back out, and it is on pit road. They're trying to get Denny Hamlin back. He's actually going to roll off of pit road here and rejoin the race. He is being shown six laps down in 30th position.
One key thing right here, with the pits being closed and these guys running around under caution this long, they can sit there and think about what they're going to do. They can talk about it a little bit. So a lot of these guys are trying to decide whether they're going to get two tires, four tires. It's going to be interesting to see what they do.
Okay, you're Steve Letarte. You said you're going to come in and you'll roll the dice now and get tires?
He's sitting in your ninth spot, and there's only 15 cars on the lead lap. So you look at, okay, what am I going to risk and what am I going to gain? If I get out front, maybe get the lead, get some clean air, might get a good top five spot. Okay, the worst thing that's going to happen is he's going to finish in the bottom part of the lead lap cars, which is around 15th.
What about Jimmy Johnson and Kyle Busch, the cars that are first and second?
Well, Jimmy Johnson's got a little more to lose. He's sitting here in second spot, and I believe I'm going to let Chad Knaus make that call.
And we haven't seen anybody back in the pack put four tires on a drive and pass everybody and go to the front. The clean air has been everything. And Alan, big decision here.
Andy used to crew chief one of these cars, didn't he? Because what he just said was exactly what Steve Letarte just told Jeff Gordon. They will pit here. We'll cover their stop in a second. First, let's go up the end of pit road, Mike.
And there was some debate in the Matt Kenseth camp whether or not to stay out. They thought if they stayed out, they get some clean air, they might be able to make it the distance. Instead, they've decided to come down pit road for a wedge adjustment and two tires. Dave?
Will the five crew nail it? A four-tire stop. They opted for four to keep the balance of the race car. So far, so good. Jack up, jack down. Oh, a little slow, but he leaves. Alan.
Jeff Gordon's team will do four tires. Steve Letarte telling Jeff they're ninth out of 15. Let's get four, adjust the car, and take our chances, Jamie.
Jack Knaus told Jimmy Johnson, if we take four this time, we stand to lose three or four positions. Is it worth it? Is it worth it? He asked his driver. Yes, they're taking four tires. The two tires stop did not help them early on, so Jimmy Johnson down and away with four fresh ones.
Race off of pit road. Newman becomes a leader, up five spots at 15.8 seconds. Stop calls Kyle Busch some positions. Back in just a moment.
ESPN's coverage of NASCAR Nextel Cup Series on ABC. Brought to you by Napa Auto Care Centers. Napa, get the good stuff. And Toyota, moving forward.
Folks, we are setting up here for a good old Texas-style shootout here. Jeff Gordon, the 24 car, being shown back in 10th position now. A moment ago, coming out of the pits, a near miss. Let's listen.
See, they're getting four tires here. They're changing these lefts and getting ready to come down off the jack.
Yeah, out there, out there, out there, out there, all the way to the grass, to the grass, to the grass, they're coming, there you go, there you go.
Didn't tell me I was three wide there, bud.
It looked like he was going to be clear to the grass except for those two cars there.
Yeah, if he was going to the grass, the rest of them were going out into grass, that's for sure.
From Harvick and Burton, he was clear all the way to the grass. Again, caution coming out of lap 298, 12th, a record-tying 12th caution here at Texas. Greg Biffle, by the way, treated and released at the infield care center after that brief smoke inhalation inside the car. He's okay. Now, we're talking about some of the downforce on these cars and how the balance is so critical to be able to get laps turning well here in this mile-and-a-half track. Let's show you what we're talking about.
Let's take a look at Jeff Burton's number 31 and Ryan Newman's number 12. They're both clean air, got downforce in the back. And watch this. Jeff Burton pulls up, and as soon as he gets behind Ryan Newman, ooh, completely gone. Now he doesn't have much downforce in the back, and now Ryan Newman doesn't have anything back there. Jeff Burton doesn't have anything in the front of his car. But if you get a little farther back, like you get the downforce back. So when you get that close, both, it really hurts both of you. Hurts the back of Newman, hurts the front of Jeff Burton.
30 laps to go. 12 car took two tires. That did the 26 car of McMurray and the 17 of Kenseth. And folks, it has been a long time since a 12 car Ryan Newman's gone to victory lane. 78 races ago. New Hampshire, September of 2005. Over 2 years, how hungry is Ryan Newman to get that win?
You got to think he's very hungry. We saw him at Lowe's Motor Speedway take the lead late in the race and then have a tire issue with the left rear spin out and lose the thing. And I'll tell you what, Ryan Newman in this situation, his short runs to the checker, he's really, really good at getting the rest.
He runs every lap like a qualifying lap. And like you said, Andy, like two laps to go at Charlotte. Had the left rear problem, almost had it won. Didn't happen.
Can he hold on? He did not only took the lead at Charlotte, like he'd been shot out of a cannon when he went by at Charlotte. Here he goes, restart. It'll be 29 laps to go as they take off into turn one. Newman trying to hold off Kenseth, McMurray, Truex, and Jimmy Johnson in fifth position.
Boy, and Matt Kenseth's got a big run on the top of the racetrack and those fresh tires. And look at that, pulls right alongside of Newman.
Well, both of these guys have right sides only, but the 17 car's been the best car.
And he's got that momentum. That top lane of the racetrack is the preferred line around here at Texas Motor Speedway. And Matt Kenseth uses that to his advantage and pulls away right now from Ryan Newman.
He figured out a little trick on his restarts, how he could run wide open through one and two on that first lap. And he just kind of snuck up on these guys and caught them by surprise.
Well, he's done it once now. Now he's got the confidence that he can do it again, Andy. You're exactly right. And he did it again just now, and it paid off for him.
99 car of Edwards is the lap car, as is the 9 car of Casey Kane. Kane back in 18th spot. Here's the 1 and 26, the Truex and McMurray cars. They are battling for third position. Truex just takes it away.
Yeah, this one car is the first car that has four tires. The 48 car also got four tires. So these guys are going to try to run these guys down with these two tires. It's going to be interesting to see if they can do it.
Boy, Martin Truex has got to be feeling great right now, knowing the rest of the guys got the two and he's got four, Andy. I mean, that is a great feeling for a driver. But can he get past the traffic? And will the clean, dirty air versus the clean air hurt him?
We're going to see. Matt Kenseth just ran one of the fastest laps of his race, even on those just right side tires, 29 flat. That's a great lap. That's about 3/10 faster than the guys behind him.
Now he's a dirty air that the number one car, Martin Truex, is in right now. That's a bad thing, but when he's got four tires, that can make up some of the aerodynamic disadvantage that he's in right now. So he's got to take advantage of that and get it done now.
Got 26 laps to do it, too. And I think if those four tires are going to help, it's going to take a little time to make this move. He's got 26 laps to do it. Plenty of time.
Here's the 5 car, Kyle Busch. Remember, he was a leader in that 15.8-second pit stop. Cost him a lot of positions. Now he is trying to reel them in. Busch has led by far the most laps today, 153 laps. So he's trying to get there, and as is the 2 car of Kurt Busch back in 7th position. Now make it 6th.
Boy, you got to hand up to Jamie McMurray. He's done a great job this afternoon. Larry Carter is crew chief. They've played everything perfect. Right now he's in the 7th position. Late in the race, 25 laps ago, he's positioned his car in the perfect time. Great job by Larry Carter.
The fastest car the last two laps has been this 48 car. You see him now moving underneath the 1 car. Man, this guy just gets it done. When it's time to go, he knows how to do it.
Jimmy Johnson finished 38th here in April. a victim of an early incident, has never won at this racetrack. In fact, Jimmy Johnson has not won at any of the final three tracks here, Phoenix or Homestead.
Guys, this is unbelievable. He wins Martinsville, he wins Atlanta, and now he's running third and he's mowing them down. 0.2 seconds faster this last time by.
Last three laps, he's the fastest car on the racetrack.
Look at how he closed on Newman, like Newman was just sitting still. Now where do you go?
But Jerry, you just go around him, because when you got that fresh tires and that car's that quick, you can almost put that car wherever you want right now. He's not going to stick behind him, that's for sure. He's going to go to the bottom or he's going to go to the top, because he doesn't have time to waste right now.
Laps are winding down, folks. We're going to take one final break and come back and carry it to the checkered flag. Can Kenseth hang on? Will Newman or Johnson get there? We'll find out in a moment. Welcome back to Fort Worth, Texas, Texas Motor Speedway, and we are setting up for a Texas-style shootout here in the final 18 laps. 17 car, Matt Kenseth is the leader, but folks, Jimmy Johnson in the 48 car is a man on a mission.
Can you believe this? The 48 car, week after week of Jimmy Johnson running down Matt Kenseth right now with 17 laps to go. And Andy, look at the speeds. What are they? I mean, it's mile and a half an hour faster than Kenseth at the moment.
He's been consistently outrunning Matt Kenseth 0.2 to a, you know, 0.1 lap. Looks like it's just a matter of time before he runs him down here.
And what did he just say? Go get us some cowboy hats?
Yeah, that's what you get for winning here. You go to Victory Lane and put on the cowboy hat.
You get to go down and visit with Eddie Gossage and have all the cowboy hats on. They put a holster on you. It's a Texas race.
Not only that, it's the biggest purse of any of these chase races that these guys are going for.
Yeah, that's all I'd say right now, because the fat lady hasn't sung yet, man. You don't get too confident. And he is a chase contender. Don't do anything crazy. You don't want to get loose underneath. Matt Kenseth's trying to take the lead. And it looks like he's going to go to the bottom and try to get it done.
Can't say it enough. It was here a year ago that Jimmy Johnson finally took the lead in the chase standings for the first time in 2006. And he never looked back. He held on at Phoenix and Homestead to become the 2006 NASCAR Nextel Cup champion. He came into the day 9 points behind his teammate, Jeff Gordon. And right now, he is 15 points ahead of Gordon in the standings.
It looks like Matt Kenseth learned something when he was racing that 11 car, because he was, you know, working the top of that racetrack seemed to be an advantage for him. But, you know, it's interesting to see how he'll do that with his 48 car. But the 24 car is moving up, too. He took four tires, and he's starting to pass some cars. Started 10th on the restart. Now he's 7th.
Yeah, Jeff Gordon up on the wheel. Remember what happened last week in Atlanta? Gordon started picking him off here and late in the race. So don't give up on Jeff Gordon yet. Up in 7th in the points and just a 15-point separation.
Now, here's what I'm seeing, though, guys. Matt Kenseth leading the race, and Jimmy Johnson's caught him. He's in the dirty air, and he's losing speed now. He's almost a 0.1 second slower than Matt these last two laps.
If you look tight, you're throwing. I don't want him outside of me, Bob.
And Kenseth's driving aggressive, and he's driving defensively also. He's taking his line away, and Jimmy just can't catch him now.
What Matt's saying, you know, I think Matt wants to run the bottom to run fast laps, but he doesn't want that 48 on the outside of him. He said, Bob, don't let him on the outside of me.
Right now, you saw the 48 just come off of turn two and really kick the back of the car out. He got loose that time. And look at the 17 pulling away in the center of the corner. So the dirty air is really playing a big effect on Jimmy Johnson right now.
Yeah, because Jimmy ran him down 0.2, a good solid 0.2 a lap, all the way till he got to the bumper. Now he's not even as fast as Matt Kenseth.
In fact, this last time by, the leader, Matt Kenseth, with a 30.66 to Jimmy Johnson's 30.80. So definitely slower. And Jimmy's going to have to get something done quick now, because he's going to tear his tires off this car trying to get around him. You see the car wiggling around now, exiting the corners.
I really think Matt Kenseth learned something while he was racing Denny Hamlin in that 11 car. That's going to pay off for him right here.
Boy, catching a guy's one thing, passing him is another. And aerodynamics is crazy, man. It just really affects these cars big time.
Okay, you got 10 laps to go, Rusty, and you're sitting here in Jimmy Johnson's spot. What are you doing? What are you going to try to do to get by him?
Right now, I'm going to the top of the racetrack. I'm going to try to build the momentum, Andy. Kenseth gets loose.
10 laps to go this time by.
You can tell they're both trying to drive like it's a qualifying lap. If I was Jimmy Johnson, I'd go to the top. I'd get to this bumper, have the momentum, and try to dive underneath them. Try to drag race them down the front straightaway and use that momentum exiting the corners as an advantage.
Okay, you know, we talked about it early, maybe even in the pre-race show, Rusty. I think I heard you say, are these guys going to be racing each other, or are they going to be racing for wins? What do you think Jimmy Johnson's doing right now?
Well, I think he's racing for a win right now. He definitely knows where Jeff Gordon is, but he's not racing Jeff Gordon right now. He's racing Matt Kenseth, and he's doing a smart job.
10 laps to go. Matt Kenseth, 2003 Cup champion, trying to hold off the reigning Cup champion. And margin coming down just a slight amount there. Will traffic be a factor? They're going to move in on some other cars here in the next 3 to 4 laps.
Remember, Jeff Burton passed Matt Kenseth right at the on the last lap of the race in the spring. And I know Matt probably learned something from that, too.
Yeah, he let Burton get on the inside, and I know Matt's probably driving as much. How much do you drive with your mirror, and how much do you drive with the windshield here now in these final laps?
Well, you drive a lot with your mirror and a lot with your windshield. And right now, they're coming up on Casey Mears, a teammate of Jimmy Johnson. What's going to happen here, guys? Let's take a look at this. Let's see if this is going to be a factor. Looks like Casey's moving out of the way, letting him have a clean race and not getting in the way. I thought something might happen there.
Top of your screen in the chase. You see Kenseth is 424 points back, folks. He could win this race and be out of the chase because you got to be 390 or less when this race is over to be still in mathematical contention for the chase championship.
Got two tires on the 17 on the last pit stop, four tires on the 48.
And that is unreal. The 48's got better tires.
But the 17's got the clean air, got the lead.
And boy, we've had some controversy this year about it.
Here he comes. Here comes Jimmy Johnson on the bottom of the racetrack. Can he hang there? Oh, 17 Kenseth pulls him on the straightaway. Johnson's got 7 more laps to try it again. Here he comes out on the bottom of the track again.
Looks like he was just saving something for this last charge, and he's got something on him.
Can he hang on? Can he grip the track? He's got the fresh tires. Kenseth does it. Kenseth, oh, a little nudge there on the right rear.
Kansas just cannot give up right now. Jimmy's committed to the bottom. He's going for it. If they get side by side too much, they could get real loose. They clear Montoya.
Jimmy Johnson cannot afford contact. He is right now the points leader.
Still there.
What a dogfight this is. I think this is really smart for Jimmy Johnson. He just laid back there just a little bit, cooled his jets a little, cooled his tires, made this run. He can just get, oh!
Whoa, hanging on. 6 laps to go, 190,000 fans on their feet at Texas Motor Speedway.
This is 2 of the best in the business going at it right here.
Right now, Kenseth doesn't want to give up. He can smell victory at Texas Motor Speedway. The largest attendance, the largest purse besides the Brickyard 400 and the Daytona 500, a big purse.
It is mano-mano here, one-on-one. 2 former Cup champions going at it. The 17 car of Matt Kenseth, the 48 of Jimmy Johnson. And here a moment ago was the contact. Watch the right rear. Whoa, watch the 17 car get out of shape.
Boy, there was almost contact there, Jerry. He got big time out of shape and stayed in the throttle, kept the momentum. And look at him outrunning Jimmy down the front straightaway. Guys, this thing isn't over. It looks like Jimmy's cooling his tires again and taking another stab at him.
Is that
here
something you'll do even this late in the race? Can you have that much discipline to say, okay, I'm going to sit here and cool these tires for a lap or so?
Hey, guys, you know what? I never had that much discipline. I just couldn't do it. If I was right there, I kept digging. But Jimmy's done a great job. We saw him do it before.
Oh, we'll be better off to finish second.
Second? If he's asking me that question, absolutely not.
I don't know why he would say that. Why would he say, am I better off to finish second?
I don't know what that means.
Here he comes again, making another run at him. 3 laps to go. Can he hold the bottom of the racetrack? Got to believe those 2 tires are going to take an effect on the 17.
Here comes Johnson. These guys are power sliding off the corner.
Like they're dirt tracking at 190 miles an hour. Can Johnson hang there? Back in the throttle for 48, Jimmy Johnson.
He's just going to take it right here. He just squeezes Matt Kenseth. You can't quite get him clear.
Unbelievable. These guys are side by side, lap after lap. Johnson's got to be smart. He's got to be smart right here.
Kenseth trying to hang on. Johnson.
Still there. White flag this time by. Still there. Barely.
Oh. No. Johnson clears him with 2 laps to go. Back in the spring, it was on the white flag that Matt Kenseth got passed. Here it's 2 laps to go. Does Kenseth have anything to try to reel him back in?
Boy, it's going to be tough right now.
Oh, look at Chad Canales. Is he loving that pass or what? By the way, Jeff Gordon in 7th position.
Boy, it's right now, Jimmy Johnson's last lap, 4-tenths of a second faster than Matt Kenseth. He's got that clean air, and now he's out of here.
You're never going to see it any better than that right there.
All I could have done was wreck him, Robbie, wreck myself. Believe me, I couldn't do anything else.
Jimmy Johnson came here 9 points out of the lead. He came to a track where he had never won a cup race. But Jimmy Johnson has driven the wheels off his Chevy, and he will win at Texas Motor Speedway.
Great job, Jimmy. Pit crew, you guys won this race. Pit crew, you guys did it. That fast pit stop, that's what did it. Jimmy, great, great driving there, buddy. Phenomenal job today, phenomenal. Well, thanks for giving me this opportunity. Woo!
Ninth win of the year, 32nd of this incredible young driver's career.
You see what he's doing right here? He's changing that brake balance bar so he can do a big time burnout right here. He's going to take all the brakes off the rear so he can just light them up.
That, he can just lock the fronts up and just spin the you know what's out of the rear tires. And boy, what a big points change, Jerry. The 24 car, Jeff Gordon, back to second place, 30 points behind Jimmy Johnson now.
A 39-point swing here in the points. Jimmy Johnson stops, and by the way, folks, from 7th to 12th, they have all been eliminated mathematically from the chase.
Boy, when it's your year, it's your year.
Well, let's talk to the winning crew chief, Chad Knaus, who just told me he doesn't know what to say, but we'll ask you anyway. Another pit call to get your driver track position. Was track position key?
Track position at this racetrack is always important, and we've actually in the past given up on adjustments to the race car just to try to get track position. And you know, it was sketchy right there with 30 some laps to go. Two tires worked pretty well, as you can see with the 17, but I really felt the four tires are gonna be better, but we had to have a good pit stop, and my guys busted off a great stop. I think it was like a 13-3 or 13-2 second pit stop, and got us out there first car on four tires. And man, I just can't say enough about Jimmy, everybody at Hendrick Motorsports, Lowe's, thanks for everybody. And man, it's just phenomenal. I can't believe it.
And the way you get most points is by winning the race. They're going to go celebrate another win in the chase. And let's go hear from Matt Kenseth.
Yep, Alan, another second place for Matt here at Texas. But what a race, Matt. Talk about trying to beat Jimmy there at the end.
Well, gosh, I hate losing, but I made it as rough on him as I could. You know, I usually wouldn't make it that rough, but I know he's racing for a championship. And, gosh, I was just doing everything I could to hold him off. So it was a great job by all these USG Sheetrock guys. Got to thank them guys for coming on board this weekend. And overall, it was a great day. He ain't getting beat. You know, I got that big lead, and you know, I can't believe all them guys got four tires. They just you know, they're really smart, and they got everything going their way. They get two and they win, they get four and we get two and we still get beat. So just a good day for us.
Can you describe saving that race car off four, Matt, when it got loose over here?
Well, I'm glad I didn't wreck, but I'm really glad I didn't wreck Jimmy. You know, I was so sideways, but you know, he had four tires, and you know, he had the grip we needed. I just didn't have a grip. I was just holding on for all I could, and I just get as close as I could to him, and you know, try to make it rough on him, but I just didn't have enough to hold him off. I knew it was a matter of time. He was kind of playing with me and watching me wear it down.
That was a great show by Matt Kenseth, the former champion who ran like a champion today. Jerry?
Indeed, what a finish. These fans of 190,000 strong got their money's worth here at Texas today. Jimmy Johnson in the backstretch doing burnouts. Here are the points. 39-point swing. Jeff Gordon now 30 points behind Jimmy Johnson. Boyer hangs on the third. Kyle Busch gains two spots to fourth. Edwards, Tony Stewart, and folks 7th through 12th are now mathematically eliminated from the chase. Let's check in where Mike is caught up with Jeff Gordon.
And Jeff Gordon brings it home 7th. How would you assess the day?
Well, it was a great fight, but we're just having to fight too hard for these types of finishes. You know, we need to be fighting that hard for wins. And just flat out got beat today. You know, we just weren't very good right from the start. We weren't very good yesterday, and I thought, you know, we could adjust on it and get it right. But there at the end, it's the best we were all day and night, and we made the most of it, you know. And disappointing day. Happy for Jimmy and those guys. I mean, they did an awesome job, because he wasn't that great early in the run either, or in the day. And so got to congratulate them. And, you know, we flat out just got beat.
What's it like fighting a team as hot as Jimmy's right now for the championship with just two to go?
You know, hey, you know, they're doing their job. I mean, I've never really focused on anybody else. I just focus on us and what we've got in our cars and setups and how we make it go as fast as we can, how we make our pit stops the best they can be. And, you know, those guys just outperforming us. That's all there is to it.
Well, Doc, two to go. And Jeff Gordon, if he wants that fifth championship, has to erase a 30-point deficit.
Thank you, Mike. NASCAR coverage continues next week in Phoenix, starting with the NASCAR Busch Series Saturday at 4 o'clock Eastern Time on ESPN2. Then on Sunday, the next to last race for the Nextel Cup Championship. It's crunch time, and only one driver has ever won a Phoenix race and the championship in the same year. You guessed it, Dale Earnhardt Sr. did it way back in 1990. NASCAR Nextel Cup Series at Phoenix. Coverage begins on ABC at 3 o'clock Eastern Time next Sunday. Jimmy Johnson over there doing a burnout. I think he burned the tires off the car over there. It's having to sort of limp back to victory lane. That left rear tire is completely flat.
Looks like he's got a left rear tire flat. We won Rockingham with Joe Nemechek, and Joe did such a burnout that he blew both rear tires off the car and just shredded them.
Well,
like
he deserves it. He's having a great time. He blew the back tires off, and he is going as slow as he's been all day long, backwards, trying to get to victory lane.
Third consecutive win for Jimmy Johnson, ninth win of 2007. 32nd of his career, his first ever win at Texas Motor Speedway. Remember, Jimmy has never won at the next two tracks coming up at Phoenix and Homestead, and there's a big hug from the car owner, Rick Hendrick, Chad Knaus, and rightfully so. Rick must have mixed emotions. One of his drivers loses the lead. Another one takes the lead here in the point standings. Coming up next, ABC World News, except on the West Coast. What a day for Jimmy Johnson. What a performance. His final lap between Jimmy Johnson and Matt Kenseth. That's exactly what NASCAR Nextel Cup Racing is all about. Two guys giving it their all, trying to hang on. Kenseth doing it with only two tires.
Unbelievable finish. Those guys, that's the most talented racing you'll ever see.
Yeah, but three in a row, three victories. Martinsville, Atlanta, and now here at Texas. Boy, when it's your year, it's your year. This team has been beyond unbelievable. They got two races left. Let's see if they can keep the momentum going.
And there's the cowboy hats.
He said, go get the cowboy hats. And Rick Hendrick's got one on right now.
By the way, coming up next, except on the West Coast, will be America's Funniest Home Videos over most of these ABC stations. You see the congratulatory discussion there going on between Chad Knaus and his driver, Jimmy Johnson. What an effort. Jimmy driving by Kenseth, and he drove cleanly, despite the fact they were both slipping and sliding those last few laps. Let the celebration begin. Let's go down to Jamie Little.
Well, the California kid is going to don a cowboy hat for the first time. Jimmy, take us through those last laps with Matt Kenseth. How surprised were you he was racing you as hard as he was despite having two new tires?
I knew it was going to be a battle to the end. And when it comes to winning these races, everybody's going to fight hard. So I expected a good fight. I didn't think his two tires would last that long or he would be that good. So, I'm just glad I was able to get by. Wasn't much time left to get it done, but this Lowe's, I guess I should say Cobalt Monte Carlo was awesome today. Wasn't the best at the start of the race, but we kept working on it and then went racing for it there at the end.
Jimmy, it was this race 1 year ago. You took over the points lead, never looked back, and became champion for the first time. Is this any indication of a repeat?
I doubt it. I mean, it's so tough from year to year to have things repeat, but I do know that we're racing for the championship, and now we have control of it, I guess. So I'm just tickled to death. These guys have been working so hard in the 24 and 48 shop. So, I mean, I just can't thank those guys enough, including the engine shop, chassis shop, everybody at Hendrick Motorsports to give us this opportunity week in and week out.
Congratulations. Jimmy Johnson wins three in a row. It hasn't been done since he did it in 2004. Doc?
Jimmy Johnson gets a big smile and a kiss from wife Shani there as Jimmy Johnson picks up his ninth win. Teammate Casey Mears over to give him a congratulatory handshake. What a day for Jimmy Johnson. Picks up win number 9 on the year. Takes the points lead by 30 points over teammate Jeff Gordon. And by the way, the big winner also was the 5 car. Kyle Busch moving up 2 spots to 4th overall in the standings. Congratulations to NASCAR Nextel Cup Texas winner Jimmy Johnson. Coming up next, except on the West Coast, America's Funniest Home Videos over most of these ABC stations. Jimmy Johnson, a winner in Texas. Thanks, folks, for watching ESPN on ABC.